1,000 yards in his high school career over at Lakewood. The guys he throws it to, David Anderson, is the third all-time leading receiver at Colorado State. Great personality and a very deceptively strong player. Up front, there are the five. Brizel Leetum with a lot of in there starting again for the second time, although we'll see Alcassel, the lineman who was injured, allowing Nick from San Diego to get in there. Pimperday and Oldenburg round out the CSU front five. As mentioned, the weather will not be a factor. It is, how about Colorado comfortable to describe the weather tonight? I know Mr. Herbstreit's happy.
I was going to say, how about perfect?
Yeah, this is great. Ryan O'Day, the kicker, kicks it away and through the end zone. It's a touchback, so the Falcon defense will have 80 yards to defend. An Air Force defense that was beat up a little bit last week by Utah. They're 75th in the country in giving up points. They do list a 3-4, but they're playing more 4-3. Gilberto Perez with Anderson, Thomas, and Mitchell up front. The linebackers, Overton Spencer, OT as teammates call him, injured last week. We'll watch him closely as he's starting this week with Drew Fowler. In the secondary, those Falcons are like safety. So Denny Poland's the best of that group with Taibbi, Bird, Giannini, and Sutton rounding out the Air Force back line. Justin Holland, the 6'3" senior, first snap of the game from his own 20 to the air, wide open. David Anderson, that leading receiver, 17 to the 37, first down. Denny Poland on the tackle.
Well, Mike, get used to saying this quite a bit tonight. David Anderson, one of the best receivers in the history of Colorado State. And this is a very nice rub route. Mike, we're going to call that a rub route here by the offense. It was not well executed, and Spence could not get through the traffic. Left Anderson wide open to pick up a big gain for CSU.
Touching the 38, so officially an 18-yard gain. Bear Creek was the high school in Lakewood where Justin set those eye-popping passing numbers. Anderson again underneath. This time is going to be marked at the 42. A gain of 4. What about the edge for each team and Kirk's Under Armour advantage?
I want to say Kyle Bell, because the importance of running the football to set up the throwing, and they're coming out in the shotgun throwing the football the first two plays with Justin Holland. But for Air Force, it's pressure. They continue to tell us that their front four is the strength of the defense. Last week against Utah, we didn't see a whole lot of that. This week, they've got to stop the run and get Holland into obvious passing situations.
Getting Russ Mitchelling, the nose tackle, in there after his injury last week will be important to that action up front. Our first look at Bell. Stopped for a gain of 1. 3rd and 5 coming up. There's Gilberto Perez out of Tampa, Florida, making the play.
Well, this Air Force defense, even though it's I don't want to say a short week because they did play last Thursday, all they have heard about is stopping Kyle Bell. Kyle Bell's coming off a game where he had 183 yards against Nevada, and no matter what Justin Holland has come out with in these first two plays, throwing on 1st and 10, eventually Colorado State's going to go back to their strength, and that's running the football. So those safeties and linebackers are going to be flying to stop Bell.
Needing to get to the 48, 3rd and 5. Out of the tight end set is the H-back Corey Sperry. The mark is going to leave Corey a yard short of the first down. Taibbi started the tackling parade. Chris Sutton cleaned it up. 4th and 1 yard for the home team.
Well, Sperry has got to do a better job of using vision. He's an H-back that they really think at this point is more of a wide receiver. If he cuts that play back into the middle, he had a lineman, Bemper, the center downfield, and he had probably another 20 yards, Mike, he could have picked up if he would have cut that play back to the middle of the field.
Chris Sutton back deep now to receive as Jimmy Kaler Kirk will kick it away for Colorado State. At elevation, so you always get good distance on your kicks here. A line drive, and Sutton let it bounce, and it will be stopped down at the 7-yard line. So a good job by Jimmy Kaler in a long field after the 46-yard not returned kick. Check the Bud Light starting lineups now for the U.S. Air Force Academy. Sean Carney runs that triple option, kid out of Ohio who played as a freshman. That's a big deal at Air Force with Hall, Handley, and Jacoby Kendrick, a good fullback, starting. Jason Brown, Aaron talked about him. Chris Evans starts at tight end because Robert McMenemy has strained his arch. 2-year starter, not going to play tonight. All experience, returning guys up front. Trey Hufford, Wilton, the center is good. Curtis Grantham, the coaches told us last night, he had a very good game against Utah. They like that senior who's in his home state. Aurora, Colorado, his hometown. Drive start from the 8. Chad Hall, the halfback, gets it on the pitch, on the run through the CSU secondary. Gain of 21. Ball came out. Colorado State says they have it. No distinctive signal yet. Robert Herbert has the ball in his hands, and the officials are chatting. Nobody's made a signal either way. Either a gain of 21 or CSU ball.
The ruling on the field was a fumble. CSU recovered. First down.
Scott Novak's our referee. Replay in use in the Mountain West, and there's a coach's challenge option to it as well.
Mike, the ball came out. Number one, you see it early in the game that Air Force is trying to break tendencies, going with a completely different play off the look that they show. But once Hall cut back into the middle, this is where it's dangerous. Big hit by Colorado State. The ball comes out, and Colorado State covers the football. Mountain West officials have taken some heat the last couple weeks. They got that call exactly right. Colorado State, first and 10.
Once they made it, they got it right.
Exactly. It took them some time. Lack of communication, but eventually the right call was made.
That is the most important thing, get it right. But
the red hanky is in effect tonight.
Each coach has the ability to challenge for the whole game. You get a challenge per half. We'll get into the stats of that later on. Great opportunity here for Colorado State, looking just a couple of yards, running Kyle Bell, the sophomore who, as was mentioned, 183 yards on 33 carries against Nevada, and that game was played here on Saturday. Colorado State playing on the short week.
Mike, you and I have been coming here a long time, my friend.
Stand by for the Kevin McDougal reference.
Kevin McDougal and Cecil Sapp. Nice. They've always had a physical running presence, and that sets up everything. Their bootlegs, their play action. They love to run the backs to try to get everything set up, and that's the play action offer.
Holland is flushed. Justin looking downfield for somebody to keep working on the route, and very wisely throws it to the front row. Good catch, buddy. All right, there's your moment. Look at him. There you go. Good job giving it back.
Like, that might look like a small play, but yeah, nice catch at the stands there by the peanut gallery. But Justin Holland has had a problem where he has so much confidence in his arm that when he gets into trouble, he sometimes feels as if he can make the throw every time, because his arm is one of the better arms in the country, and he's very accurate. So he sometimes gets himself into trouble, and the coaches like to see that. They feel like he's learning when he throws the ball away.
Nice grab. Used his hands, didn't use his body.
No body at all.
Yeah, it was nice. 18 to the 18 for a first down with a flag thrown here. And we'll hear from Scott Novak again.
Prior to the snap, false start, offense, number 76. Third down.
Looks like Josh Day peeked his head up there a little bit too soon, the right guard. Early in the game, sometimes the adrenaline's running. You're trying to get back into pass protection, trying to get a little bit of a head start. And now what was, I don't want to say makeable, but you're 3rd and 7. Now all of a sudden you're in 3rd and 12, and it makes the play calling responsibility much, much tougher for Colorado State.
You've also turned an incompletion into a 47-yard field goal into the wind. The 5 may be a point. It's pressure from Air Force. Holland, nice fake to keep the play alive. Get back to the line and gain a yard. So instead of losing 8 or 10, he gets 1, and the field goal attempt will be into the wind from 46 yards. Gilberto Perez and O.T. Spence did all the chasing there.
That time, Air Force went from their 4-3, Mike, to a 3-man front, and it just confused the offensive line. And then they brought outside linebacker pressure, and there was complete confusion up front from Colorado State, and it allowed Spence to come in free. Really good job by Holland to avoid the pressure and still keep his team in field goal range.
Late decision to bring out Kevin Mark, who's done kickoffs the last 2 years. As you see, not a great body of work as a place kicker. Missed a 44-yarder against Colorado in Boulder. This from 46. No good. So had the leg to get it there, but it drifted to the left. And Air Force will take over. So another turnover by Air Force's offense. The defensive Fisher DeBerry does the job. It's been a story all year long. Back on College Football Primetime. Give credit to this Air Force defense. the sudden change situation. That's the lingo of footballese. When your defense is put with its back to the wall, and they were excited. Fisher DeBerry's team was jumping up and down. The coach with a few high fives after that one. Kirk, it's the sixth time that the offense has turned it over on its own half of midfield. And they've only given up 13 points out of those turnovers. The first down run for Jacoby Kendrick, the fullback, against this Colorado State defense, gains about six. They know what they're going to get. They see Air Force once a year, every year, so they are ready to handle the triple option with Nading, Park, Blake Smith, and Terrence Carter. Nading has a couple of sacks. That's tops on this team. Jamal Hill, Courtney Jones, and Jeff Hrinick, second of this team in tackles, the lead backer. Darrell Williams is the corner with Robert Herbert, who came up with the fumble before. Travis Garcia and Coach Aver. Again on the ground. Again a turnover. Courtney Jones comes away with it for Colorado State. So Air Force turns it over by fumble for the seventh time this year. And the defense got to do it again.
All right. Richard Bell and the Air Force defense has to run out and make another play. This is a quarterback. You have to proper read. And then when he came down the line, Jamal Hall was right in the face of Sean Kearney. When you're running this offense, it's a good read on the dive. When you take it to the next phase, which is the pitch phase, you've got to be ready. And Sean Kearney knows that he's got to be able to dish that ball with his left hand as fast as he can and expect those outside linebackers to be crashing down on him as soon as he comes off that play fake.
So one more time, turned over inside their own 30. The Air Force defense asked to respond. Holland tried to throw for the middle. That pass got deflected. The middle of the field was open so much last week. Anderson didn't get there.
The other, we're talking about a team and a defense with a fragile mindset. They're coming off a couple tough losses. The game could have gone either way the last few weeks against Wyoming and Utah. And now the first two times they get out here, it's off of two of the first three times they're out here off of turnovers deep in their own territory. Middle of the field, and also, Mike, Utah last week, Kyle Whittingham attacked into the end zone off a lot of those turnovers and came up with points, and that's something that CSU looked to right there off of the turnover.
Another snap of five wide against the four-man rush. Time, there's the middle, and it's caught at the seven-yard line by the H-back Sperry. 10th catch of the year, a gain of 21.
Mike, that was actually pretty good coverage. Last week against Utah, there are a lot of times there weren't any Falcon defenders within 10 or 15 yards. This time, Giannini, the safety, is right there. He just at the last second, Sperry broke loose, and you get an idea how Holland could throw the football.
Slight contact downfield. Drew Fowler was trying to tackle him. Still, Sperry got free. 6'6" and 210 pounds. First and goal. Bell to the one. Kyle Bell takes it to the door for Colorado State.
Mike, this offense reminds me so much of Wisconsin as far as the stretch play and the zone play. When you have a tailback, you've got to have fantastic vision. And vision means you don't necessarily know when the ball is handed to you where the hole might be. You've got to be able to stretch it to a certain point and then either cut back or find the seam. And that's what Bell's been able to do last couple weeks, is find that seam.
Trying to take it in that time, kept his legs driving, but never broke the plane. Mark Ratner, the line judge, was right there, and you see his right foot saying third and about 90 blades of grass.
We talked yesterday with Colorado State and their coaching staff. They said when we get into this situation, we'll promise you that behind the center, Albert Bemper and Josh Day, the right guard, this is where we're going to try to take the football in third and short and down and close by the goal line.
Part of that punishing play to Air Force Falcons hurt Gilberto Perez. Is the lineman who was shaken up. There you see Perez there. I'm not sure if the DB Chris Sutton was the other player who was down. We'll keep an eye on it. Yeah, it is Chris. And both of them with the training staff looking at their legs. Sutton's been involved in some early plays, started all the games, the best pure cover player. And against a Colorado State team, that's going to be important.
Anytime you get down in the goal line, you have a pile of bodies. You always wonder which way you get a guy's leg stuck somewhere. You always wonder what could happen. You hope that Sutton looks like he's going to be okay. Have to see about Perez.
Sutton actually hit Perez as he came across from the top of your screen as you were watching the replay. So the two players converging on the ball converged on each other, and now we'll have third and that much. It's Colorado State's third drive of the game, two coming via Air Force fumbles. Big Tristan Walker in there, offset to block for Bell, who is stopped by Spence, keeps fighting and gets in for the touchdown. Second, maybe third effort, getting Kyle Bell his second touchdown of the year.
Gives you an idea of how strong Kyle Bell is as a runner. Spence is there. He's kind of caught behind a blocker, but Giannini, number 11, has a chance to pull Bell back, but he holds on to the football as opposed to wrapping up around Bell and pulling him out of the goal line, or away from the goal line.
Extra point knocked home by Kevin Mark. Second time this season, Colorado State's inherited a turnover, turned it into a touchdown. 7-0, Rams score first.
ESPN's College Football Primetime is presented by Cooper Tire's Ultimate Bowl Tour. Go to a Cooper dealer near you or visit ultimatebowltour.com to enter. And in part by Chevy, the new Chevrolets, an American revolution.
What is that, Herbie? 300 yards maybe from the edge of the stadium?
From the northeast corner there, just off to the side.
It's the only stadium where you have a livestock view from the press box. And they've redone the press box. This place looks great.
It sure does.
As good as we've ever seen Hughes Stadium look. Touchback on the kickoff, so Air Force is going to take over the 20. Let's watch some blocking.
Well, Tristan Walker, the fullback, needs to get over on the other side of the ball and play some linebacker. Watch his tackle on Spence, the linebacker. Watch this. Yeah! And the best is the official's right there. You can't get any closer to that touchdown. You can't get any closer to being in front of an official and tackling a linebacker trying to make a play. Woo! Still six. 6 points up on the board.
See if Air Force can hold on to it. They've been very benevolent with the ball, giving it up twice in three snaps. The option pitch to Chad Smith. Hit hard after a gain of four by Robert Herbert. Again,
uncharacteristic of Sean Kearney to put the ball on the ground coming off an option. They worked so hard on the option phase and the pitch relationship. And as a quarterback now that's gaining a lot of experience after last year and coming into this year, I think you're going to see two things now. You're going to see them get back to the basics. They've got to be able to get their fullback going. And the fullback is the most important aspect of this option attack for Air Force.
Yet to see Jacoby Kendrick coming off the knee injury and thigh bruise last week. Play clock down to one. Here is the first run for Kendrick up to the 28 and a half. Left third and about a yard and a half. And let's go back to last week and remind everyone, when you don't see triple option all the time, why a good fullback makes your offense that much more dangerous.
Well, Chuck Peterson made a good point to me just yesterday. We're talking about that. What happens is Colorado State's defense, if the fullback is established and he's picking up 5 or 6 or 7 yards at a time, it forces the linebackers and the safeties and the rest of the defense to come in and have to defend from the outside in instead of inside out. And that's when the quarterback will start to pull the ball and start to get around the corner, and the play action pass works as well.
Third and a long one. It is Kendrick who is stopped shy of the first down. So they adjusted the play. The motion is the window dressing. They couldn't sneak the fullback through that first line. Air Force will go three and out after Courtney Jones makes his second big play of the game.
And one of the benefits of playing in the Mountain West and seeing Air Force's triple option attack year after year after year is you can throw some things away and keep some things. And this is the thing that, even though it's a young defense, their coaches have a very good idea of how to defend it. Jesse Nading that time came down and took the play away.
Donnie Heaton, a beautiful kick. What a rocket end. Turns over. Oh, you got to stop this one. What a shame. That would have been the kick of the year. 71-yard punt, and he almost knocked it inside the 20. Still, it's a net of 51 and a fabulous kick by Heaton.
That's some great college football action for you on ESPN.
Virginia Tech, West Virginia. What a scene it'll be in Morgantown at noon Eastern. And Charlie Weiss and Notre Dame go to West Lafayette. Purdue a little emotionally dinged after their loss last week. 77th meeting between these in-state rivals. That's our college football doubleheader on ESPN Saturday.
How about Purdue's run defense against Lawrence Maroney in Minnesota?
How about anybody against Maroney and company? It's incomplete. Johnny Walker had a knee on the ground anyway. And let's go back down to the field and Aaron.
Hey, Mike, good news for Air Force's defense. While their offense is struggling, both Gilberto Perez and Chris Sutton back on the field. They both were leg whipped. Chris Sutton actually has his left shin taped up with some pads around it, but they both say they're fine. By the way, Colorado cool, this Floridian is freezing, guys.
Oh, what?
Freezing.
I am.
Freezing.
Will you stop?
Can you imagine?
Freezing. It's like 58 degrees out there.
Some of the night. It's cold, Herbie.
How about some of the nights we've had here? Oh, gosh.
This is balmy.
Holland, good arm. Right back to Johnny Walker. 20 yards, first down. At the 40, Walker is a Californian from Lancaster. He's averaging 20 and a half a grab, and he didn't hurt it on that one.
It's the thing that's somewhat surprising is seeing their ability to come back and throw some on first and 10 and trying to get the ball downfield. The way I think you can attack Air Force in the mismatch is going to be Colorado State's collection of receivers. If Holland has time to throw against the Air Force secondary, as much as Colorado State wants to run, Mike, big, big advantage with their speed out on the perimeter.
Holland, 5 of 7 passing for 66 yards, adding to it. But Walker dropped it, so Johnny Walker's 1 for 3 on this set. He's dropped 2, and that's a 20-yard gain.
Well, Johnny Walker, as a sophomore, he was an option quarterback in high school. He's picked up the wide receiver position pretty good, but that is a catch he should make every single time, despite Bird coming up, giving him the incomplete sign. It should be another completion for Colorado State.
Sonny's telling hands. There you go.
Sonny's got fire now, Mike. He's got some fire in him.
No, how fun was that sitting with him yesterday?
Oh, gosh. We didn't get into the game at all, but it was just fun talking to him.
It was great. Second and 10. Ball out. And a third turnover of this first quarter. The first one belonging to Air Force. So the Falcons get it in Ram territory. Eric Anderson able to knock it free.
Mike, the timing here is off between Holland and George Hill. Now, George Hill is probably the most explosive back and wide receiver slash running back that Colorado State has. But the exchange there, I don't think he's familiar with taking handoffs. He's listed as a split end as a wide receiver. But because of his speed, they try to get him in there as a running back. But he just didn't handle the ball from Justin Holland.
I don't remember him having a carry all year, even on a reverse. So Carney goes back with the option, and he'll gain about 4 yards on that one. Jeff Hrinick, the redshirt freshman linebacker out of Kansas, comes up with the play. But back to the story of the quarterback, Carney, for the Air Force Academy. When you come in as a freshman in Air Force, you have so many responsibilities to start your basic training. That's why very few freshmen play varsity. Most of them play junior varsity. Carney was so impressive and so good early on that he earned a spot and then eventually earned the lion's share of the quarterback time last year. Good option toss there, a yard shy of the first down with Kent McCarthy, the sophomore out of Wichita Falls, Texas. Guys, the word used, Kirk, by the folks around Air Force last year for Carney coming in as a freshman were remarkable. A lot of them gave the credit to the big program polish that he had out of high school, so he was not awed by the situation coming in as a freshman. He was asked to do a lot and did a lot last season.
I'm really impressed thinking about being a freshman and watching him this year with his composure. Even after mistakes, he does a great job of maintaining his composure.
Jacoby Kendrick, the fullback, trying to bounce that to the outside, or had to bounce it to the outside. Denied by Jamal Hill, and fourth and a yard coming up.
Air Force, I think, on the road, coming off these losses, you got to go for it, Mike. But if they do pick up a first down, the thing I'm telling you right now is Colorado State does not respect the passing game at all. They have 10 guys up there all attacking the line of scrimmage. At some point, Kearney's going to have to find Jason Brown, number 9, and try to get him in a one-on-one matchup and get him the football. But right now, they got to have a sneak or a fullback and just pick up the first.
Kearney takes it and makes it, and they'll get a first down. You saw it's their 9th conversion on fourth down. They go for it on fourth down a lot because they're in a lot of fourth and a yard and a half, fourth and a
yeah. Third,
and they feel like they can pick it up pretty easily.
Sure, you pick it up 2 yards at a clip, 3, 4, 5. A lot of times you find yourself in a position being in fourth and 1 or 1.5. But they are one thing they have to do now, Mike. You've seen they picked up some big yards early, even though they turned the ball over. Colorado State now has pinned their ears back, and they're attacking Kendrick, the fullback, and Kearney. I think they have to try to get the ball thrown downfield.
After the first Air Force first down of the night, that's the way it should look. So McCarthy almost got to the edge. Miles Cookshaver made a nice play otherwise. Kip McCarthy might have taken that the rest of the way.
Well, the safeties, we talked a lot about it last week, and we'll talk about it a lot this week. Cookshaver this time is responsible for the pitch. Almost the angle that he took almost caught up to him there. He's very, very fortunate because if Cookshaver doesn't make this play, Mike, he has a block downfield. McCarthy is into the end zone for a touchdown. That's another way to get away from that pressure. They're pinning everything into the middle, the Colorado State defense. They've got to try to get the ball, bounce to the outside, or as I said, throw it over the top of them.
From the 21, Kearney throwing. It is complete. Inbounds to Jacoby Kendrick. We'll have a third down coming up in about 3 here in the final 2 minutes of the first quarter.
You touched about Kearney. You talked about Kearney and what he's been able to do. Mike, last week when he went down, or out of the game, not with an injury, but they took him out. Fitch came in, the backup quarterback, provided the spark, got him almost back to the game. They were an onside kick away from at least having a shot after being, seemed like, out of the game. Kearney's come back here tonight, obviously is the starting quarterback, but he's come back with a character again being tested after a few mistakes early in this game.
Third and about 2.5. Quick toss. Maybe just shy of the first down with Kip McCarthy. So again, we'll have fourth and less than a yard, and we'll see if Fisher DeBerry goes for it again on fourth down. Miles Cookshaver, second time, the free safety.
This Colorado State defense, Mike, is flying around. We're talking so much about what Air Force is trying to do. You see what I'm saying, though, about when the safeties and the linebackers, that as soon as they see any type of action at all, they are flying up to the line of scrimmage to take away the backs of the fullback and the quarterback.
We're going to get a measurement. The spot ended up being a little bit more generous than it looked when it was initially brought down. Safeties play such a huge role in every game, but especially against an option team, because you are at that last line of defense with so much attention given to the run inside. Healthy foot.
What was the number you gave? How many conversions on fourth down?
They now have 9.
Okay, number 10 will probably be coming up here with another quarterback sneak.
9 of 10.
9 of 10, 10 of 11 coming up. But I do want, I want to touch on your point, because if I'm an Air Force offensive coach and I'm sitting up here and I'm seeing those safeties and I'm seeing them not respect, they're getting a head start on the pitch, they're getting a head start coming down and helping on the fullback. At some point, whether it's a bootleg like you saw with Kearney, or it's even a straight drop back trying to get the ball eventually to Brown, if a defense isn't respecting that aspect, you almost have to do something to try to slow them down.
Everybody's sneaking up. Kearney pushing forward. It looks to have gotten across the 14, and that'll be there for the first down. So it is 10 of 11. I like the point you make about Air Force's offense, because that is the joy of watching the triple option with somebody who can throw it like Kearney, because you get all your attention, you're doing everything possible to shut them down, and one play goes over your head, and now you're messed up for the rest of the night.
Well, that's going to slow you down a step. Now you're going to have to sit back and respect that phase, and then that's when they're able to get the methodical option game going.
From the 13, Kearney slips and falls. A self-sack back at the 20-yard line. Loss of 7 for the sophomore quarterback.
Mike, the Air Force coaches are seeing what you and I are talking about, because coming off of the play action, the bootleg, which is a lot of the action they'll use, look downfield, you have some receivers. If he doesn't slip, you have some receivers downfield. They're getting ready to break loose and get into the open. The fullback was all alone in the flat.
Second and 17. Straight drop for Kearney. Incomplete. The player touched was a Colorado State man, as it was intended for Jason Brown, who Aaron highlighted at the top of the game, coming off the 9-catch, 184-yard performance last week at Utah. Air Force's season, the win in Seattle against Washington, which was technically their home game, moved to the Seahawks Stadium downtown, 20-17, beat San Diego State at home by 12, then lost to Wyoming by 1 in Colorado Springs, a botched extra point and a Wyoming comeback, and last week a three-point loss at Utah, where Air Force came back from down 17 to make the Utes sweat. Third and 17, Kearney comes out, throws it, incomplete. It was right in the hands of Greg Kirkwood, but the senior out of Washington couldn't pull it down as he was getting prepared to get popped. Fourth down field goal coming up.
Well, that's a wide receiver's worst nightmare, is having to come from the backside, coming all the way across the middle, and then the ball is floating in the air is almost as if it's not going to ever come down. You know, either a safety or a corner, or this case, and a defensive end is waiting for you. And I think that time Kirkwood might have peeked down there to see what was coming up.
Officially 37 for Scott Everly out of Winona, Minnesota. The punter Heaton is the holder. And Brian Jones, 54, the rest of the snap hold kick unit. And executed well enough for 3 points. 7-3 as Air Force gets on the board. Song, by the way. Now tonight, Applebee's hometown hero, some of the people around the program who make it special, this man, the video coordinator for Colorado State, Jim Harrell.
Tuesday's practice consists of about 24 periods where we do a lot of individual drills. As soon as the drill's done, we drop the tape, we run the tape back into the office, and then we digitize it in our DVC Prodex. We are able to get this drill that just happened 5 minutes ago into our machines and share it to the coach. The last thing the players see before they go out on the field is our weekly highlight video, which I have two students shoot the footage, take all their highlights from the previous game, which in this case it was Nevada, and then we produce it and show it to the players.
So from getting them mentally prepared for the X's and O's to getting them psyched up mentally for the game, those video coordinators around the country, all over, do such a great job, and they are part of the lifeblood of college football. Unreturnable kickoff, 4 seconds left in the first.
All I can tell you, Mike, is just in 5 years, 10 years, the difference between being a coach or a player breaking down film, it's come just... It is so far, the technology is so far now. And
well, for one, it's not film anymore.
It's not film. I mean, it's almost like having, you know, watching this broadcast, having, you know, high def and being able to look at things. They break it down by down and distance. They break it down by any blitz package you might want to look at, certain tendencies. It is incredible the work that they do and how they simplify it for people like you and I to be able to just sit there and hit you. We go in and look at some tape, we hit the mouse, and there's a little bit of a wager on whether or not we can get it running without the film guy.
Final seconds here of the quarter. Bell is stopped for a loss of a couple. That's right. Like all the third and seven plays, third and seven or more, all in one file. Just click on it, you watch them for the whole season.
Yep.
It's a great preparation for these teams. These guys know each other quite well. Through one, 7-3 for the home team. Colorado State on top of Air Force. Quarter number two, college football primetime, presented by Cooper Tires. It's the sixth time in the last 8 years that Air Force and Colorado State have done their 120-mile-away dance together on a Thursday night. We've been here for most of those, and nice to be back in Fort Collins, especially at the end of September as opposed to early November. Wasn't this the game that forced Corso to actually get a winter coat?
I think it was.
Here?
It might have been down in Colorado Springs where he came out with it.
That was, that's right. Yeah, that's right.
The jacket.
Second and 11 to start the quarter for CSU. Kyle Bell runs right. First down and more. Tripped up at the 35.
by Carson Bird. Otherwise, he would have gone a long way. Josh Day, a nice block on a 16-yard gain.
There's the running game that they, at this point, have not been able to get established. But once they do get Kyle Bell going, it has an ability to set up Justin Holland. But the thing that you just touched on, Mike, is the line play. They have four really good, talented offensive linemen that they feel that they can move the football and be that physical outfit that they want to be, because it all starts for this group up front by pushing that big Air Force defensive linebacker.
Led by that center, Albert Bimper. Bell. Aaron, he got 6 yards there.
Mike, actually, Kirk, you mentioned Colorado State trying to get that running game going. Such a problem last season, so much of a problem that they actually asked Kyle Bell to pull that red shirt of his. He told me he wasn't ready to do so last year. He wasn't ready to make the jump, but this year a lot more confident. He said the biggest thing that helped him out was the weight room, knowing what to do during the offseason, guys.
You know, Aaron, they didn't have a running back gain over 450 yards last year. That is so atypical of Colorado State. First two games against good competition, and they got behind, they couldn't run. But against Nevada, they got back into what Sonny Lubick's teams have always done well. And here Holland takes a timeout. Stepping out with them. Minute and change into the second. Rams lead by four.
ESPN's College Football Primetime. Brought to you by Olive Garden. When you're here, your family. And Oppenheimer Funds, the right way to invest.
With Aaron Andrews and Kirk Herbstreit, Mike Tirico. Glad to have you with us in Fort Collins, Colorado. 7-3 after the Colorado State timeout. Second down. We'll call it four. H-back Corey Sperry in motion. Bell gets the first down at the 47. We got a Sports Center 30 and 30 for you. And once again, here's Reese Davis.
All right, Mike, for the first time since the 2000 season, there is joy on the south side of Chicago. Paul Konerko hit his 40th home run. White Sox beat the Tigers 4-2, and they clinch the AL Central, something they appear to be in danger of losing in an epic collapse after having a 15-game lead in early August. So the AL East and the wild card still up for grabs. At the moment, Yankees up 5-0 over Baltimore. Red Sox getting beat 4-1 by Toronto. Tribe winning 6-0. Yankees one-game lead in the East, Mike.
All right, RD, keep an eye on that stuff. Here is Holland throwing. Intercepted. That is the third time a receiver didn't handle it. And staying on his feet is Chris Sutton, finally brought down. Dustin Osborne, he had it right in his hands. He had a first down, but he delivered it to Sutton, who comes up with the interception.
Well said, Mike. Johnny Walker doing it a little earlier, and now this time Osborne, the ball is thrown well. You've got to hold on to the football. These Air Force defensive backs are struggling, staying with Colorado State. The ball is put right where you got to make the catch. It was actually a really good job of Sutton reacting to the ball being in his face rather quickly. And he was able, nice presence of mind to make the interception. But Colorado State, hold on to the football.
That's our fourth turnover here in the first 16 and a half tonight. Back to the option. And the pitch with Chad Hall to the 38-yard line. Jamal Hill, who had 9 tackles to lead Colorado State in their game at Minnesota, made the play.
It's another great example of how Colorado State, especially on first and 10, they're just flying up to the line of scrimmage. I want you to watch this time right here, Coach Schaefer, the safety. As soon as he sees option action, even though he doesn't make the play, turns it back into the inside, he is just taking off in a full sprint to try to get to that quarterback and get to the pitch man.
This time, 4 players outside of the tackle box try to lighten it up in there, and they throw out of it right at the first down line. I believe it's Greg Kirkwood. No, it's not. Check that. It's Victor Thompson, the third receiver, just his second catch of the year.
And until Chuck Peterson, the offensive coordinator from Air Force, I think decides to do something, quick throws like that, something to stretch this defense vertically, to try to stretch them vertically, even horizontally, try to get them back away from the line of scrimmage. Everybody talks about the spread offense and how much we see the spread offense. One of the reasons is to keep the defense away from crowding the line of scrimmage so you can make decisions a lot easier. Close one.
First and 10, they were dialed in there, right at the end of the line.
been that way since week one, Ben.
Yeah, they've done a good job all season.
But I guess what I'm saying is, even though you're running this option attack, you still have to do something to slow them down, and I don't think they're going to be able to find their rhythm with that option until they do. Because right now the fullback is non-existent.
And we should just remind people, you talked about this last week, you ran triple option in high school, and there's so much based on your familiarity with everyone and also the rhythm of the offense and getting into that rhythm, because it can be very demoralizing for the defense when you get it rolling.
If you take the fullback away from the triple option, you stop the triple option.
They haven't picked up a third down, but they've picked up 2 fourth-and-inches on the night, and this is the same thing, getting to the 45-yard line with Carney, only 5'10", 190 pounds. He's playing his 15th game as quarterback.
I tell you, they're lock in if it's third and short or fourth and short, the old sneak with Carney.
Well, okay, John Wilton and Grantham and Hufford, the other guard, they are just mowing people down. It's John out of Tampa, Florida, first team all-conference performer. Carney to throw out of the backfield for Chad Smith. Had a lot of options. He'll get Chad for 9 yards. May have had more elsewhere on that play, but still second and short coming up.
Mike, they could have taken a shot there down the field vertically. And if nothing else, just throw it as far as you can. And if you look, there's Kochifer's out of position now. You have the middle of the field all to yourself. Even though they picked up a nice gain, he dumped it off, picked up a nice gain. The middle of the field, he could have thrown it 50 yards downfield. That alone will slow down Kochifer, the safety, and Garcia, the safeties, from running up to the line of scrimmage.
Ryan Williams in there at fullback now for Air Force, has been most of this drive. And they come instead to Chad Hall, big opening up the middle, and that's it. Once they hit one, now the playbook really opens up for you.
I say nothing. I mean, as soon as you do something just to slow down the defense enough, all it takes with Air Force's attack is just a little crease, because it's about blocking angles and look at the great blocks upfield. And more importantly, look how the pressure is slowed down from Colorado State just by taking that little down the line, off the line, and the threat of going over top of the safeties. That was just enough. I watched Coach for that time, and for a split second, he paused as a safety, and that was enough there to give him a running lane.
After gains of 10 and 15, the option, beautiful move for another 9-yard pickup by Chad Hall. And this is what the option can do to you. One, demoralize you, and the yards start to come in big chunks.
The other thing that happens when you're a defense, you have a short week to prepare. You're so used to playing, they kept telling us, Monty Kiffin visits Colorado State. He's a good friend of Sonny Lubick, and we play the Tampa 2 and the zone blitzes. Well, this week they take all that and throw it away. They've had 3 or 4 days to get ready for a completely different mindset. Well, all of a sudden, when you start to make them think a little bit because of that pass, they go back to reverting back to some old habits.
Second and one, up the middle again with Ryan Williams, and a first down to the 14-yard line of Colorado State. It's the best sustained drive of the night for Air Force. Yardage is about even. Score, just a 4-point difference. You mentioned Monty Kiffin. He is the well-respected defensive coordinator for the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. And that Tampa 2, cover 2, kind of safe, keep everything in front of your defense. Everybody plays some of it sometime during the season, pros and college, it seems. Play 8 of this drive. It's covered 52 yards so far. And Williams only for a couple of yards at the fullback spot. Blake Smith there with the tackle.
Defensive line from Colorado State with Nading at one end and Carter at the other, Smith and Park in the middle, doing a really good job here early in this football game. I thought it was interesting talking with Sonny Lubick and his defensive coaches, talking about how Colorado State, instead of getting upfield, we teach them so much to get upfield against a traditional offense. This week, it's about getting horizontal, trying to move and slant left to right, right to left. Different philosophy from what they're accustomed to, but so far, they're holding up very well in the trenches.
Second and 8, keep by Carney, who is met there at the 10-yard line. Third and 6 coming up. John Radford, a backup linebacker, junior college transfer, He grew up in Tulsa, went to school at Northeast Oklahoma A&M, and now here at Colorado State, forcing the third down.
Now down inside, closer to the 10-yard line, be interesting to see how Air Force plans to attack. Jason Brown, who's got the size advantage over Colorado State, is coming off the big week. He's 6'4". But first, he started to come off the field. Now he'll be at the top of the screen. He'll be isolated there one-on-one to see if he can get a chance to make a play against Robert Herbert.
Chad Hall in motion, comes back to get it. Couldn't cut it back. Fourth down about 3.5 yards, so field goal range here for the Falcons. Jesse Nading made the play that forces the field goal unit off.
The fact that Chuck Peterson elected not to go to the throw tells me that right now, with the way Carney's throwing the football, that maybe he's not 100% confident with Carney and maybe his rhythm right now throwing the football. So they decided to be a little bit safe, got it in a position now to kick the field goal and get within a point here midway through the second quarter.
This attempt 25 just inside the right hash mark for Scott Eberle. Bad snap, good hold, timing off, kick good anyway. Donnie Heaton, who hit that fabulous punt before, did a nice job on a poor snap. Both turnovers have turned into field goals. This has turned into a one-point game. 7-6 here. Let me remind you, as you plan your weekend, ESPN game plan online or on your TV via your cable operator or satellite provider. Extra coverage, all the ABC regional action, Michigan, Michigan State. If you're not scheduled to see that like some of you out west, USC, Arizona State. Let's say you're in Florida and you're going to get Syracuse, Florida State Saturday afternoon on ABC. Dial up game plan and you will see the games you want to see, whether online or on your cable or satellite provider's extra channels. 7-6, first kickoff return of the night on a short kick. It is returned out to the 25-yard line by George Hill. Last week, Herbie was really handicapped by a poor fullback to show the example of the mesh point.
Well, look at the eyes on the quarterback. Typically, when you, in normal offense, when you hand the ball off, you're looking at the back and then carrying out your fake. This is a option read, triple option read, where you have no idea whether you're going to hand the ball off or if you're going to end up giving it to the fullback. And it was a really good look at the eyes of the quarterback and what he's trying to see before he makes that decision.
And the fullback doesn't know either, right?
No, nobody knows. I mean, nobody has any idea until you make the read and until you make that decision. I mean, it could come out, it could stay in, and of course, if you keep it, you go to the next level. And I just want. This is a great look at what a triple option does to the quarterback. He's not even thinking about looking. And this is, you take a shot, shoulder pad into the face. You got to continue to make your read. I mean, that's all part of it. And ball's in there. And if the quarterback decides to pull it, the fullback has to know it's a soft squeeze and let go. And the quarterback takes it and goes to the next.
How do option quarterbacks handle all this pressure? You guys, you're all
special. Come on.
Oh, you're all terrific.
Yeah, I hear you.
Oh, here is Bell, right side to the 42-yard line. This just came up on the air, and Phil Orleans, our producer, and Mike Schwab, our director, got us great shots. But we have to go back to when
this is great stuff, special,
right? Oklahoma.
Oh my gosh. I mean, when you make the pitch there. Look at this falling down. Oh my gosh. Oh, Billy Sims. Air Force has a different feel there when it comes to their pitch.
Some great
Billy Sims and the boys back at Oklahoma. Remember Jamel Holloway and Charles?
J.C. Watts there. He went on, obviously, to his political career in Washington. Some great Orange Bowls. It seems like every New Year's night, they ended up down in the Orange Bowl. Don Cricky did the games on NBC. You can hear some great memories. We have some movement here on Colorado State. Going to back it up to 3rd and 8.
I asked Kyle Whittingham, I said, head coach at Utah, I said, what would happen if you had the prized recruits to go to USC and Tennessee and LSU and Ohio State?
Number 64.
If they decided to go, if there was an Oklahoma of today, would it be successful? He said they'd move up and down the field. He said, now, it's never going to happen because kids today want to go to the NFL, and you're not going to get to the NFL by playing in that kind of offense. But
right.
He said, if that wasn't taken into consideration, and you just took the special athletes, the Reggie Bushes and Ted Ginns and all those kind of guys, and put them in that kind of offense, he said you couldn't stop it. It'd be impossible to stop.
And the backs were the ones who went on to the NFL careers out of that system. Billy Sims made an immediate impact with the Lions, a terrific back until injuries slowed him down. But the rest of the skill guys wouldn't. You're right. Third and 8 after the flag on a load of the offensive lineman is caught, but shy of the first down. A great play by Denny Poland to stop Matt Bartz or Luke Roberts from picking up the first down, and Colorado State will punt it away.
Actually, a really good play by Air Force here on third down. There's man-to-man on the outside. Poland comes in to make this play. Now, you got to remember, Air Force's secondary tonight and last week against Utah has been exposed against the speed of Utah and the pass game. And that time, perfect position by Poland to make the stop and to force the punt.
Jimmy Kaler to kick it away. Good kick. The wind and the elevation, 57 yards, but room to return it back to the 29-yard line for Chris Sutton. So decent field position for Air Force as we come back on this beautiful evening in Fort Collins.
Chance to win one of 100 Philips HD TVs with DirecTV service for a year. Log on to 100yardblitz.com to enter. The code word is Colorado Springs.
Heard Mike and Mike talking about that on ESPN Radio this morning out here. We're not in Colorado Springs, but it's just as beautiful here, 127 miles north on I-25 in Fort Collins. Denver's in the middle.
Give me a rod and a reel.
You want to go fishing?
Yeah.
Are you a fisher?
Yeah, I'd love to get out there and do a little fly fishing.
Do you fly fish?
No, I never have my life, but I want to.
Here is Jason Brown, first down. Gain of a couple yards. You spent all of last week trying to get your free skiing up at where?
Squaw Valley up in Park City.
Park City? You tried to work that for us last week. Squaw Valley. Squaw Valley. You're trying to get that going.
Deer Valley.
Is it too late now? Now you want people to take you fly fishing?
Yeah, I'd love to go fly fishing.
You got a cell phone?
The problem is, this is it for the Mountain West and us on Thursday night.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we're not going to be able to come out here and, well, maybe we'll come out
and visit on vacation.
Big vacation over the summer. I know you get awfully busy there with the NBA and golf and whatnot. NBA goes into August, and that kind of takes you out.
Yeah, that three-month season you work is great. Second down and 8 here for Sean Kearney out of Ohio, the quarterback. Back to work, looking downfield for Brown. Hauls it in. That's what they've been setting up all night. And they finally hit it. Jacoby Kendrick threw a great block to help him along the way.
Mike, this is what we've been waiting to see, and you knew that eventually they were going to have to get in a position to make this play and to show what they can do. The thing that I like is how they move Jason Brown around. He is one-on-one with a linebacker, and that is something that Sean Kearney sees at sleep and just dreams about getting an opportunity. Jason Brown is a receiver, 6'4", 225, going up against a linebacker. That's what they need to slow down this Colorado State defense.
From the 31, Chad Hall, the halfback, for a yard and a half. Aaron has more on the man who made that big play.
Well, always a big night for Jason Brown when he goes up against a Colorado team. He grew up 50 minutes away from here. He was telling me, you know, no scholarship offers from any of those teams. And Chuck Peterson told us yesterday, if he'd play for a big school, there would be a lot more people talking about Jason Brown. So he's into putting on a good show here tonight, guys.
And Aaron, I think what we might see with Jason Brown, and we'll talk about this the more we go on, but a future, if he gets to the NFL, if he has that opportunity, put some weight on Jason Brown. What a great H-backer tied in at the next level with his speed.
Second and 8 from the 29. The pressure's on. Kearney gets rid of it very wisely. Incomplete. We'll have a third down coming up. You know, Brown, against Wyoming a couple of weeks ago, he played 20 snaps at tackle. We had to ask Chuck Peterson, the offensive coordinator, that he really a tackle, and he's just such a good blocker, and then allows you to hide him as they did on that last play and hit a big one.
Unbalanced line, and they make him eligible as a tackle, and you can sneak him out and get him lined up against a linebacker. And that won't be the last time you'll see that tonight. I can promise you they're going to eventually try to do it again, and he's going to be at the top of your screen to see if they can get him the football again on third and 8.
Darrell Williams comes up. He's got safety help behind him. Kearney surveys it, takes off, and is going to be a yard shy of the first down. The ball came out after he was down.
What do you know? 4th and 8 inches.
They've gone for and made a couple of those already here tonight. Twice they've gone for 4th and less than a yard, and they've made a 3rd and less than a yard.
Love how the linemen always give you that sign when the coach is trying to make a decision. the big boys are always showing the coach, come on, let's go, let's go.
We're going to go get the points and go for the field.
We can get it.
Here.
We own these guys. Fisher to Berry, member of the AARP, says, fellas, I'll take the 3 points and let's get the lead.
Eberle will try the field goal. A timeout taken here by Fisher to Berry and Air Force. It was going to be a 39-yard field goal. Oh, and he threw the challenge flag. I beg your pardon.
Yeah, there we go. We'll get the red flag out.
Are you going to challenge the spot, perhaps, here?
Yep. Might as well pick up two or three more inches. He can go for it, right?
Lose a timeout.
That's a good yard short.
Yeah, I think the spot was dead on. Just so you know, coming in, the conference commissioner here in the Mountain West, Craig Thompson, dropped off these numbers to us. 17 games here in the conference season. That's 3,131 plays, over 3,000 plays. Only 25 times the game's been stopped for instant replay. 13 have been done by the booth, and 12 have been done by coach's challenge. Now, we saw Fisher DeBerry drop the red flag for a coach's challenge, but they upstairs tell us they might be looking to see if it's a fumble. I didn't think it was fumble, unless Sonny Lubick dropped his red flag on the other side. So they'll get this all straightened out for us.
Mike, I don't know about you, but I don't know if I'd throw the hanky when what's in question is the fumble. You know, I mean, if I'm Fisher DeBerry, I want to try to move on to the next play.
Yes.
I don't know if I really want to have the guys upstairs say, yeah, by the way, the spot, not only is the spot right, but you fumbled. Green ball. His knee's down, so he'll be okay. But I wouldn't be surprised to see, we'll have to see what Air Force decides to do if they do hold on to the possession. Because they've got a different huddle right now going on the near sideline. Carney's right in there.
Hate to tell you I'm bewildered, but I am.
Well, I'm a little bit surprised that Fisher DeBerry threw the red flag for the spot.
Right. It wasn't
within inches. It was more of a full yard. But his knee is down while he has possession of the ball. So they'll maintain possession, but it's still going to be fourth down.
Okay. The replay booth calls our TV truck, and they said that they call to find out if it was a fumble or not from above. But then we saw Fisher DeBerry had the red flag out.
Right.
And he threw the red flag. This is the only conference where you're allowed to have the coach's challenge. And we go through all the plays that are reviewable. The spot is reviewable in the NFL. It's not determined that the spot of the ball is one of the reviewable plays on all those magic lists of what is reviewable and not in college football.
That's not a field goal speech. That's not, I promise you, he's not talking about, now hit it through the uprights.
Yeah,
no, he's saying, we're going. We're going to own him at the line of scrimmage.
Would you? Well, he could just take a timeout. I'm just thinking, would he have thrown the coach's challenge flag to stop the game, call timeout?
Yeah. Now, that's an AARP move.
Your veteran coach's move?
Yes.
The experience?
Yes. Yes. I think I like that. I like that. But
just give me an answer here. It is fourth down, by the way, fourth and about a yard. And I'd love to tell you why they're waiting, I don't know why. But we anxiously await Scott Novak's decision.
After review, the ruling on the field stands. The spot is correct. Air Force will be charged. A team timeout. It'll be fourth down.
Yeah, Aaron. Well, let's go to Aaron first. Go ahead.
Herbie, you were mentioning when the offensive linemen are pointing, hey, let's go at fourth and one. John Wilson, the center, seeking out Coach DeBerry and saying, Coach, trust us. Trust us. Let it do it. He's going to try it right here, guys.
He He wasted a timeout. He might as well have called a timeout and saved us.
He just wanted to leave us out on a limb for about 3 minutes there.
Oh, gosh.
All right, here we go. Fourth and one. It's a full one. And it's giving the Colorado State kids a couple of minutes to get riled up. Carney, quick toss. First down to the 18-yard line to Hall. So all that fourth and one action inside, inside, inside.
Great call.
Beautiful.
Great call by Chuck Peterson. Every time they've been in a short yard situation, it's been a sneak. It's been the fullback up the middle. Colorado State shooting the gaps in the middle, trying to take Carney out of this, taking Kendrick out of this. And Air Force goes away from their tendencies and pitches it to the outside, picks up a great block, and enough for the first down to keep this drive alive.
Chad Smith made the block on Travis Garcia. From the 19. Try a fullback carry to the 16-yard line. Jacoby Kendrick, the starter. Ryan Williams came in the last drive, and Jacoby returns to the field in this series.
I cannot get over how impressive Colorado State, for such a young defense, how aggressive they are on that side of the football. Sometimes there's hesitation in defending the option because you're not real sure. You've had 3 or 4 days to get ready for an offense you don't see. Sometimes there's hesitation. Tonight, there's been no hesitation by Colorado State.
Back to Kendrick, trying to reestablish the fullback. We'll have third and about four coming up as that defensive line being tested and stretched out. Gets Terrence Carter out of Topeka, Kansas to make the play there. Missed this game last year with an injury. Six sacks up front. He's the top career sack guy. This isn't a sack game. This is about controlling the run.
Again, I'm going to assume that this is a great opportunity to try to run a bootleg or try to run something and try to get your quarterback the option of running or throwing the football to a matchup that he likes.
We'll take this all the way down and take time out here. Fisher DeBerry just working the timeouts, working the red flag, working the clock, keeping this long drive alive. Doubleheader this week on ESPN. Of course, all the games on ESPN2 and ESPNU, but these are beauties. Virginia Tech, West Virginia, and then in prime time, presented by Polaroid, Notre Dame at Purdue, 7:45 Eastern.
Virginia Tech going into a rivalry game in a hostile environment. I'm not saying they're going to lose, but they've got a lot of people patting them on the back this week. Always get worried about rivalry games on the road. Remember Michael Vick in 99?
Oh, yeah.
Morgantown against a very okay, average West Virginia team, and they barely got out of there alive. It took a Michael Vick scramble. I just wouldn't assume that that's an automatic victory for Virginia Tech. I wouldn't be shocked at all to see Rich Rodriguez have his guys fired up. You know the fans will be fired up for that one.
Both teams are 4-0. West Virginia's also 4-0.
Just a lot of patting on the back. Frank Beamer will be, that's probably his worst fear, is having a team being told how great they are. Oh, you're 11-0. Oh, it's a done deal. You're 11-0.
We'll hear from Frank at halftime.
Good.
Reese and Mark have him all dialed in for our halftime guest. Third and five. Carney swings it out. It's caught. What a hit. Terrific hit on Chad Smith by Lucas Davis, the sophomore. Fourth down coming up.
They have a saying here at Colorado State. They want to play hard, and they want to play fast, and they want to play together. And that's what this defense has done in this first half. This is knowing your tendencies and being able to come up and make plays. I mean, these guys are all over the field. Anything that is not down the field, Colorado State has covered.
Timeout taken by Sonny Lubick before this 30-yard field goal. He wants to, I guess, check out what's going on before the field goal. I don't think he's trying to ice the kicker necessarily. Minute 29 left. Good throwing quarterback. Could have preserved that timeout. Well, while we have a second, we mentioned Reese and Mark. Let's see what the guys have all set for halftime. Reese?
All right, Mike, coming up on that Pontiac Performance Halftime Report, we'll visit with Frank Beamer about that upcoming trip to Morgantown. We'll tell you about the baseball hunt for October and also deliver the Pontiac game-changing performance.
I'll let you know if Jim Levitt, South Florida Bulls, can pull their second consecutive upset over a top 10 team.
Number nine last time, number nine this time.
This isn't your mother's Louisville team. This is your father's Miami.
Okay, so are you saying that they're South Florida's daddy?
Nah, I think
so. Is that what you're saying?
They're the Bulls.
We'll see. See you in halftime in a few minutes, Mike.
Okay, guys.
One thing, guys, you know for sure is South Florida if they're hoping to come in off the radar after what they did last week. They've caught Larry Coker and the Miami Hurricanes full attention on film this week.
Yeah, they've got a flight number now.
Yeah.
They're not sneaking under it. No way. South Florida, very interesting. Since 2001, they've had 7 players taken in the NFL draft. So they've been harvesting some talent, so this is not completely unexpected. But the volume of the win over Louisville shocked everyone. Eberle will put one here up from 30 after makes it 37-25. Last snap wasn't so good. This one wasn't too hot either, but they convert it, and it is a 9-7 Air Force lead. So Sean Carney, the quarterback, leads it down the field. 9-7 game. Good option quarterback play. Sonny Lubick has seen Fisher DeBerry's team. Fisher DeBerry has a great eye for option quarterbacks. We showed him one when we met with him yesterday.
All right, guys, I got a guy here I want you to look at, 3 or 4 clips. I think the guy's got a lot of potential. Certainly has got good physical size here on the counter option. Option's the end man on the line of scrimmage, pretty doggone good. I'm sure I'm impressed with the way he's carrying the football right there. Boy, what a good move on those two guys right there. His reading ability looks pretty good. His fundamental ability looks pretty good right there. His mechanics look pretty good. He doesn't carry out his fake there very well. I'm not so sure that guy didn't hinder that. But he certainly read very well. I think the young man has some skills.
How great is that?
Gosh, that's extreme. Fisher DeBerry breaking
down
the triple option.
You love Fisher DeBerry. That's your
own. I bow down to Fisher DeBerry. That is... You caught me off guard there.
How good is that, huh? Centerville High School,
that is
Ohio,
great.
Where this guy went, has produced some great players. Mike Nugent, the terrific kicker at Ohio State. And, of course, now A.J. Hawk, the outstanding linebacker. Oh, questionable decision here to bring this out. Will cause Colorado State field position. Good coverage by Air Force. Brings downhill back at the 10-yard line.
I'll tell you this, just to let you know how much I love Fisher DeBerry, my high school coach, Bob Gregg, actually came out to Air Force before my junior year and studied their wishbone attack.
Oh, really?
And put in the exact same offense that Air Force had and implemented it. So the same terminology and everything
that
we had in our high school was learned from Fisher DeBerry and the Air Force attack. So
who's the coach there now? Coach Ullery?
Coach Ron Ullery is now the coach. And you mentioned A.J. Hawk, who's kind of carrying on the tradition. Nugent.
Nick Mangold, the other captain at Ohio State, is the center of the Buckeye team. He's the captain of offense. That's funny stuff.
Guys got me though.
We totally got you. They may have Holland here. What a play by Holland. He avoided a safety with the strength of his body, his big frame, and his arm, or else that would have been 2 points for Air Force. Minute 11 left and one timeout for the Rams.
Well, that's the last thing you need if you're Colorado State getting into the half here. Trying to maybe come up with a break, and with your receivers, it makes a lot of sense, even though they're backed up, to try to get the ball downfield. But, man, Justin Holland, once he got outside of that tackle area, very wise to get rid of the football.
Tony, Gilberto Perez up front defensively for Air Force has made about 4 plays tonight and almost had a big one there. Seems a while since we've seen Colorado State's offense.
Yep.
This whole second quarter has been Air Force. They've taken over control of the game in time of possession. Got to stay inbounds. Bell bumped out of bounds. And now with 1:06 left, if Air Force can stop them.
One more time!
You can hear Coach DeBerry. Great audio, guys. One more time, stop them. Get the timeout. They have to kick it back to Air Force.
One thing you can always count on, and I don't know if Aaron's going to get a chance to talk with Fisher coming, we're going to have a chance to hear from Fisher DeBerry, but always great television. He's always, man, I just wish he could get out there and make a play. He does everything but get out there and put the pads on.
He's 67, Sonny Lubick is 68, and they're not, one word of your mind would say these are old guys. They have such energy and passion for what they do. Holland down the middle, caught, first down at the 35-yard line by Corey Sperry. So that weak spot of the Air Force defense exploited for 19 yards there.
Mike, pitch and catch, double cross move from the Colorado State receivers. And right now, when Holland has time, it's the middle of the field again where the Air Force defense is being exposed. The linebackers aren't dropping back deep enough, and the secondary can't stay with the speed of Colorado State's receivers.
Taking its final timeout, Colorado State.
And they're rushing 3, but they're also blitzing. And look how well Colorado State picks it up. Once you pick up the blitz, there are some huge windows because the linebackers are gone. They've come on the blitz. The middle linebackers are gone, and it opens it up nicely for Holland. It's a great job again by that big, strong Colorado State offensive line, and the backs staying in to pick up that blitz.
We mentioned Fisher, 67, Sonny, 68. This is the oldest age matchup you have of head coaches in Division 1A head-to-head. They are fifth and sixth in age. Bobby Bowden and Joe Paterno at 1 and 2 at the top of that list. Then we saw Howard Schnellenberger and Florida Atlantic earlier this year at Dolphin Stadium. And then Bobby Ross and Army. What a great game they played last Friday.
Played the hearts and should have won the game.
Against Iowa State. Aaron has more.
We were talking to some of the Colorado State players yesterday about Sonny Lubick. David Anderson, colorful guy, I know you guys can add more to that, said, hey, despite how old our coach is, he's running around and screaming at us in practice. Of course, Sonny Lubick not looking that old for his age. He could do a good impression of him, too, guys.
I think he likes you, to be honest with you.
Knock it off. You like his hair, Herbie.
The hair.
David Anderson, you guys talking about?
Yeah,
Sonny,
yeah, David Anderson.
The wide receiver. Sonny, you know, for the folks who don't remember, he was the defensive coordinator. Yeah, you two have your own conversation, please. He was the defensive coordinator at Miami. Russell Maryland, Cortez Kennedy, Jesse Armstead, Darren Smith. All those names, guys who went on in the league for years. Sonny Lubick was their defensive coordinator now over at Miami.
He said his job was just not to screw it up. They went out and recruited all those great players. Just stay out of the way.
After Jimmy Johnson's staff brought in some of those amazing players. Out of their final timeout, from their own 35, there's the big arm of Holland. Down the middle again, caught. Sperry cannot be separated from the ball to the 38-yard line. Pickup of 27. No timeouts, 48 seconds left. That's why I question why they took that last timeout before the field goal. They may need it down here.
Mike, it's funny. We're thinking, well, do they really want to start this drive and try to pick up points? And now they're not only thinking field goal, they're thinking about maybe trying to get a touchdown.
From the 38, emphatically stop the clock with the spike. 46 seconds left. Corey Sperry's had a nice first half.
He has. Sperry's finding that soft spot in the zone. Look how far back, almost in that prevent mindset, the Air Force defense is. Right now, they're flying around trying to find a guy head on a swivel. Meanwhile, Sperry's just turning and finding that opening, and four catches for 70 yards tonight. He's finding plenty of openings in that Air Force secondary.
It's about Vomhoff, the backup defensive lineman, speaking of hairdos. The 38 Air Force brings pressure. Holland is protected. Throws it complete to David Anderson. Yard shy of the first down at the 29, but most importantly, out of bounds, so Holland can huddle them with 40 seconds to go.
Mike, there's the arm strength that we've talked about from Justin Holland. Now, Justin Holland might be off your radar a little bit with Matt Leinart and all the great quarterbacks. He threw that from the right hash all the way to the left boundary by just stepping and throwing. It wasn't low down by his hips. Didn't have to go down to his knees. It was right at his numbers. Justin Holland has an incredibly strong arm and very accurate.
And that's the throw that tells you the
NFL arm.
Yep, from the hash, the long out across the field, some 35 yards. Third and a yard. Look at that pocket. He's got time. Put it up top, incomplete. Trying to hit it all with Dustin Osborne and the Air Force cadets who are over there. Give it a little holler out to Chris Sutton for his coverage.
I'll never forget 2 or 3 years ago, you and I had a Colorado State game and
yes.
Saw Justin Holland warming up as a freshman, and I just said to Sonny Lubick down on the field before the game, I said, who is this guy, number 8? He just has one of those fluid deliveries where it's almost effortless at how the ball explodes out of his hand. And he will be when I see the NFL and what's going on with the New York Jets, yeah. Justin Holland right now has a job waiting for him at the next level somewhere. I promise you that with his arm. If he can continue to make good decisions, he's got the physical tools.
Fourth and a yard, too long for the field goal. They will go and be right at the line. I think the clock is going to stop for the measurement of Kyle Bell. The spot looks like a first down here with 28 seconds left. Now, good job by Holland. He's getting them up to the line in case there's not a measurement, so they're ready to spike the ball once the chains are in place. If the referee says let's measure, they'll bring him out, but they're not. And CSU isn't going to waste any time here.
Well, Holland, instead of spiking the ball, he's got plenty of time to get a play called at the line of scrimmage. And when you're out of timeouts, you need to be able to get the play called and execute that play.
Chain set, takes it, spikes it in a second, 27 seconds. So often teams do that. And I think in college, when you know the chains are moving, in that situation, you can sneak a play.
Yeah, and I know if you look at the downs and you look at the time, you think, well, do they really need three or four downs? I mean, the time's more of an issue than downs, and I understand that. But at the same time, you'd love to see a quarterback, if the ball were back, let's say, at the 30 or the 40 of their own in their own territory. Once the clock stops and it takes time to get the chain set up, you've got a good 10 seconds to communicate to everybody. You're at home. Communication isn't a problem. You get everybody lined up. I understand, though, with the plays, time's more of an issue than the second or third down.
Air Force pressure off the corners. Holland for the home run. It is caught for the touchdown. Luke Roberts, first of the year.
Mike, two coaching points here for you. Number one, if you're a defensive back, you've got to find the football. Giannini cannot find the ball. By the time he does, when he looks back, it's done. The play's over. And the second thing is, great job by Luke Roberts of using his hands to high point the football. You always hear coaches talking to youngsters about the importance of not using your shoulder pads. Use your hands to catch the ball. And that's what Roberts did a very good job of for a young sophomore. It's pretty good technique and nice job of going up and catching that football. But Giannini has to turn and find that ball before the time he did. Nice job by Roberts.
And Holland was 4 of 6 on the drive for all 82 yards, except for that one run on fourth down and the touchdown for Luke Roberts. Fisher DeBerry called timeout because Colorado State's lining up to go for two with the game 13-9 here. Usually very early to be going for a two-point conversion, but it would make it a six-point margin instead of five.
This could be a good debate on College Game Day. You know, that's the new thing right now with Lee Fitting is we get into some huge...
Lee's the producer of the show.
We get into some good discussions.
Like anybody knows who Lee is.
Well, I'm just saying. We get into some good heated discussions and battles. And maybe a good one would be to go for two or not to go for two early in the game. We have to save that one, get into it, because I don't think it's, in my opinion, I don't like to go for two this early in the game unless you think the scoring is going to be at a minimum in the second half. I think every point counts at this point, and if you think the second half you're going to see some more scoring, then I think right now it's more about just getting points on the board as opposed to trying to go for two.
The one thing when you play Air Force, you have fewer possessions because they keep it long when they're rolling, and that may change your decision-making process. Like it is here for Sonny Lubin. They go for two with Holland. Incomplete. They try to use the size advantage of Sperry against Denny Poland. They don't get it, and the margin remains four.
How about 88 yards and 10 plays in a minute five?
And you were one down away from coming off the field. Sonny wanted pass interference. Go get him, Sonny. He's in great shape. Chased that inside judge down 30 yards.
On the pass interference call. It'd be interesting to watch in the second half if the points become an issue.
Yeah.
You know, become an issue. I think it's pretty good coverage. They do have the advantage, but the ball is thrown. Gets a little bit of the right hand around the waist. It's one of those calls could go either way.
These are two gentlemen who have built programs. When they became the head coach at Air Force and Colorado State, respectively, each school only had a couple of winning seasons in the prior decade. So they really weren't getting a great job handed to them and said, go get it. Sonny Lubick has made Fort Collins relevant. I mean, when Colorado has beaten Colorado State the last 3 years in close games, CU throws a party like they've come up with a huge win, and it is huge in state. But it's different. This is a Big 12 school with a massive budget against a Mountain West school with a smaller budget. Sonny Lubick making this program has made that game a real intense rivalry.
People wonder how you create rivalries. You win games. I mean, when you're the underdog, all it took was Colorado State to win a few times, and all of a sudden CU fans didn't take that game for granted.
It was interesting. It almost looked like his knee was up after he caught the ball. He went down to a knee, caught it, and then picked his knee up, and that's what Fisher's trying to fight. Instead, it'll be down at the 18 with one snap away here. Here's a comparison to these two very successful longtime head coaches. How about that 35 years in coaching as a head coach here and just five losing seasons for both of these guys. And both trying to turn around last season. A lot of the motivation for a 67 and a 68-year-old. Colorado State was 4-7 last year and just the third losing Fisher DeBerry season at 04.
Both guys are the kind of guys when you sit down to talk to them about the game, you go on a half hour about something involved in the sport, the game of college football, and then the last 3 minutes you talk about the game. You talk with the coordinators about the game, but you just want to sit and listen to these great coaches.
To a knee into the locker room, and we will hit halftime here in Fort Collins with the Rams on top of Air Force 13-9. And Aaron Andrews going to chase down Coach DeBerry. Go ahead, Aaron.
Coach, your offense has been in the red zone three times, limiting you to field goals. How do you maximize those opportunities in the second?
Well, obviously, Aaron, we got to put the ball in the end zone. We cannot swap field goals for touchdowns, and we've had the opportunity. Our defense has done a good job. You got to give them a lot of credit. We had the kid covered down there. They made a great play on it, but we've got to come back and execute our offense. I like the way we control the ball there in the middle of the second quarter, but when we get down there close, we got to come and put the ball in the end zone.
Coach, thanks. Herbie, I know that fired you up.
Like we said at the top, these are not great teams nationally, but they give you a great game every year. 13-9 at the break. Pontiac Performance Halftime Report now. With Mark May, here's Reese Davis.
All right, Mike, good Mountain West game. Fisher fired up. Rally the troops, as always. Glad to have you on. We'll talk plenty about football. We'll have a visit with Frank Beamer coming up in just a little bit. But first, a little baseball action mayday. Going into the final weekend of the season, coming into the day, four of the divisions have been settled. The American League Central had not been. White Sox needed only to beat Detroit. With Freddie Garcia on the hill, White Sox got off to a great start doing just that. 3-0, and then Paul Konerko delivered his 40th home run of the year. We put it on the board. Yes! For the first time since 2000, the White Sox, the division champions, taking the Central 4-2, the final over the Tigers. But we still have a race in the American League East. Yankees hammering the Orioles. Manny just hit a home run for the Red Sox. Red Sox a game back in the East. Red Sox and Indians tied for the wild card. Indians about to win their game. Red Sox have work to do. And, of course, the Yankees and the Red Sox play this weekend. And in the National League, we still have the wild card to settle there as well. The Astros, if they can come back and win this game, they clinch no worse than a playoff game on Monday to determine the wild card winner. And, obviously, they'd have the whole weekend to try to win a game and take care of that without the extra game. Still to come on the Pontiac Performance Halftime Report, Frank Beamer taking a team into Morgantown, eerily reminiscent of his last trip there. We'll see what he has to say.
What do you do for your offense in the second?
Oh, they're blitzing every play and trying to really take our running game away, but we're going to still try to establish that. I really, that was, he can pass the football, but he's having a hard protection. Is we've been okay, but they're bringing more people than we can protect with, but we're fine. Defense got to keep playing. Hey, they've had a great first half.
You certainly did. Thank you, Coach.
Thank you, Aaron. That defense was on the field for 17 and a half minutes in the first half, but held Air Force relatively in check, under 4 yards per carry. And Carney, the quarterback, gets more than that. Sean with a gain of 6. And Kirk, why don't we look at the numbers after the break?
Well, the thing that stands out to me is that Colorado State's only had 47 yards rushing. But you know what? They haven't had to run the football because Holland and his group of receivers have had a chance to get the ball vertically downfield. The thing that I've seen is that Air Force has to do something to slow down this Colorado State defense. For them to be able to move the ball consistently, they're going to have to do that, or they're going to face a lot of second and third longs.
Here's the option toss. Chad Hall on the edge. Look out! Pushed out of bounds at the 30-yard line. A pickup of 43. Give credit to the blocks, Chad Smith, and that man, Jason Brown, the receiver.
It's all about picking up the blocks on the perimeter, and Jason Brown set it up. Once the ball gets pitched to the outside, Brown has two big blocks, and then another block set up by Chad Smith, and then the speed of Hall to get downfield. But you got to see what Jason Brown did here. When he cracks right there, and then he goes for another guy.
two big blocks by Jason Brown, who's known for making big catches, showing that he's got the toughness to make the block.
Pick up a 43. Hall's average 12 per. Galloping into the secondary, Chad Smith, Air Force touchdown. They put on a blocking clinic on those three plays for 80 yards.
When the option is able to get going, Mike, you come back with the counter, and it's a great call. Great job by Chuck Peterson in the execution. I don't know what was said at halftime, but three plays, 80 yards. That execution was flawless on those three plays by Air Force.
Brown, Kendrick, the guys who carry the load very often, did the blocking on those few plays. Everly for the extra point to make it a three-point game. Now that point that Colorado State didn't kick, I think is going to factor in as we go through. Well, that was quick. 52 seconds, 80 yards, three plays. The halfbacks getting most of the work done. Chad Smith out of River Oaks, Texas, to the end zone for his first time.
ESPN's College Football Primetime, brought to you by Taco Bell. Think outside the box. And Under Armour Performance Apparel. The advantage is undeniable.
Back here in Fort Collins, the thing Chad Smith likes the most about Coach Fisher DeBerry, how he and the staff reminds the players after every game to call their families. Well, when he calls back to his family in Texas, he can tell them about his first varsity touchdown there to put Air Force on top by three, first minute of this third quarter. Return comes shy of the 20. Well covered by Air Force as they try to bring it back.
Mike, it's interesting to see how Colorado State's blitzing the linebackers. Hurnix comes right up the middle now. Great blocking up front. Watch this right here. Coach Haver, the free safety, he's got to execute between the umpire, Hanley coming across. By the time he realizes what's going on, Chad Smith is right by him and running in for a touchdown. Remember the safeties, how active they were and how they were all over the field stopping the run game? That time, Coach Haver had to deal with an umpire and a receiver blocking him.
First down, the return. Kyle Bell starts with a gain of about 8.5, 9 yards. What's interesting in this game, Kirk, is Air Force's success this year on the ground has been their fullbacks. Their halfbacks have played a much bigger role. They're an inexperienced group that has gotten some game experience, and they've been the significant guys, in part because that's what Colorado State has given Air Force's offense tonight.
Over the years, Air Force is an option team with the fullback and a quarterback carrying the bulk of the load, and the halfbacks doing what they have to.
Tristan Walker on the edge trying to block. Kyle Bell slipped, and he's a couple of yards shy of a first down. Namdi O'Harry is a junior running back for Colorado State. He's a UCLA transfer. He spent a couple of years on the defensive side of the ball, always wanted to be an offensive player, and finally left UCLA knowing he wasn't going to get a chance to carry the ball. He went to Colorado State, was going to be their starting back, and just into the early part of the game against Colorado, O'Harry injured his ankle, one of those high ankle sprains. Cleared to play tonight. We haven't seen him yet. It's been Kyle Bell doing most of the work at tailback. Now third and two, it's one more ring for Bell. That extra effort plus the push from the center, Albert Bimper, will get the first down out at the 30-yard line.
Mike, years and years and years would pass, and you and I would watch Colorado State, and it seemed like Joel Dreesen was here for 5 years. But the one thing he offered this offense was being an H-back, being big enough to be physical like a fullback, but they could also slide him out into the flat, and he could catch the football. Right now, Colorado State is stuck a little bit between having Corey Sperry, number 80, who's got size at 6'6", but he only weighs 210. He's kind of an H-back, but he can't quite hold up like a fullback. So Tristan Walker, number 33, comes in for the two-back stuff.
And here he is just able to squirm forward for a couple of yards.
The only problem is when you're preparing as a defense and you see the difference, okay, when 80 comes into the game, guys, expect to play action, expect the pass game. At a Corey Sperry, who's 6'6", and I guess he's 233 pounds.
But when you see that they're in a two-back and Tristan Walker is back there, the tendency shows that they're going to run the football more often than not, and it changes the impact and how you defend this Colorado State team. That's why Joel Dreesen was so valuable to this offense.
Sixth-round pick by the Jets. Bell again. He does a really good job fighting for every yard. He's not the breakaway back who's going to just kind of take it all the way down the field, but he keeps going and gets that extra couple of yards.
Well, he's not the biggest running back, but he does a good job at his pad level. He stays low, and the other thing is, Mike, like all Colorado State running backs, he keeps his feet moving, and he's pushing that pile back.
That's a word I hear every week. Why is pad level important?
Pad level is important. It's the whole reason you get into the weight room and you work your legs and work your squats, and so whoever gets lower, you're back in that position to explode and use your hips and use the power that you have from lifting weights. And some guys have that natural hip explosion. Some guys never really quite catch on to it.
Play pass, taking the deep shot, downfield for Roberts. Did he haul it in? Yes, Luke Roberts with the catch right about the 20-yard line. So set up for that third and short run, they go the play pass between Giannini and Bird and gain 44.
Mike, I don't know if Herman Edwards is watching this game tonight, but he would love to have Justin Holland Sunday. I'm telling you, Justin Holland is a guy that you're not going to hear a whole lot about nationally, but the play-action fake, the safeties, Giannini comes up because it's third and short, and then the touch. He's got an arm to be able to throw the 20-yard out from the hash to the sideline. Then he has the touch to be able to go over the top on third and short and make a perfect throw, and what a great catch there that time by Luke Roberts. Luke Roberts has put on a display tonight of using the hands to catch the football.
This play is being reviewed. They're checking to see if Roberts cradled it in. Now, when we get to the NFL reviews, very often when the field is used to help the player haul the ball in, sometimes it's deemed not a catch. He did have complete control of holding the ball at the upper half as he rolled over. The ball never comes loose in this situation. It's a tight call.
That is a tough call. The ball came up after it initially touched his hands, but he secured the football. And then it's just, you can see the ball looks like, Mike, it touches the ground, but you just wonder if his hand was underneath there, then he still was securing the football. The ball comes up. How about the concentration to be able to bring it in?
Indisputable video evidence. There's a little bit of a roll of the ball once he makes impact with the ground, and unless you have both hands like mitts on it holding it so that it doesn't jar loose when it hits the ground, sometimes it can be overturned.
Did you see the ball pop up after he
right there, just a hair,
but it didn't ever leave his hands? That's might be indisputable. I have to see
hand contact stays with it. Again, call on the field as a catch has to be indisputable video evidence, those three words, to be a catch, to be overturned, excuse me.
Whether or not this is overturned or not, great catch.
Oh, yeah.
Great effort by Roberts. But Justin Holland, he's just really, really impressing me with his arm strength and his touch.
After review, the play stands as called on the field. That's a completed catch.
It was kind of that gray area you're talking about, Mike, where it's indisputable. You just can't see the ball. There's nothing that showed the ball pop up after he came down. You can make an argument that, yeah, it touched the ground, but he's securing the football. It never left his possession.
Just depends which side of Denver do you live on. Do you live north? He used the ground to catch it. South? It came out. Holland turns it, tosses it. End zone. Touchdown. What an arm he has. Goodness. David Anderson. Second touchdown of the year. Rams back on top.
Mike, when Justin Holland makes good decisions with the football, when his mind is there and he's making good decisions and not forcing the ball in, this guy has a ton of ability. Put me officially on the Justin Holland bandwagon. This guy is a nice quarterback.
Again, less than 10 players in the history of high school football thrown for over 10,000 yards. Holland is one of them, and he hits Anderson for the touchdown there.
We've seen Justin Holland do a lot of things tonight. We've seen his arm strength. Here he gives you an idea of his athletic ability, moving to the outside, getting outside, and putting the ball on a rope to Anderson for a big touchdown for Colorado State.
Last four scores have led to lead changes. Colorado State and Air Force delivering one more time. Four and a half in, third quarter at Fort Collins. Justin Holland, healthy this season, and the arm is absolutely fine. What a throw that was. Kirk will take you through it in a second. Indecision, take a knee. Air Force will take it back at the 20-yard line.
Justin Holland, about 6'3", 205 pounds. What you're seeing is versatility from a quarterback. Arm strength on the run throws an absolute perfect strike to Anderson. And the thing about Anderson is you can almost feel the relationship between Holland and Anderson. They've worked so much together. A little bit of a push, but the ball is thrown exactly where it has to be, low in a way where only Anderson can make the catch.
That in response to the three-play 80-yard drive. Carney will throw it on first down, completed out to Kirkwood. 4-24, and here's Aaron for more on the quarterback for Colorado State.
Mike, Justin Holland told us yesterday he spent a lot of time during the offseason looking at video of Utah's former Utah quarterback, Alex Smith. He said he liked to notice the way he stayed very, very poised in the pocket. He didn't rush anything, and he erred on the side of caution, not going for the big play if it wasn't too safe. And guys, Sonny Lubick said it best yesterday. He is a very accurate passer, maybe one of the best in the country.
And that's not something, Aaron, that Sonny Lubick would just throw on top of his quarterback. When he says that, he really means it.
Option picks. The halfback's doing a nice job. The ball came out after, clearly after, Chad Hall was down. Looks like Air Force will have a first down. We have an injured Colorado State player, Terrence Carter, slow to get up, but he gets himself back to the huddle on his own power.
Mike, this time we talked so much about the safeties and how they have to come up and fill the alley. Coach Schaefer is coming up this time to be in the position. First half, he makes his tackle. This time, the adjustment and the athletic ability here we're seeing from the Air Force running backs. Chad Hall cuts back up, and this time picks up the first down. First half, they make that play by Colorado State.
Hall's the move man. He's in the play action fake. Carney hit. He threw it out there. Incomplete for the other halfback, Chad Smith. Smith, who ran for the touchdown on the last drive. Travis Garcia in coverage back there.
I like the call there that Air Force just taking a little bit of a chance there, trying to find a one-on-one matchup. Chad Smith almost came up with a catch. The ball's just a little bit overthrown, but they've been distributing the football tonight. I mean, it's been all over the place. A lot of times you would see the fullback up at the top, the quarterback would be next, and then the halfbacks would be down the line. But because of the way Colorado State is defending them, it's forced Chuck Peterson as a play caller to get the halfbacks more involved.
Straight drop back for Carney. Incomplete for Jason Brown. That time the defensive arms of Jesse Nading knocking it away.
The key in stopping this Air Force attack is once you get them to throw on first and 10, now they get the second and 10, and now you start to get a little bit more predictable with what you might do. Surprised they went with a flanker screen back into the boundary as opposed to trying to get Brown out to the field where he can make somebody miss.
Third and 10, another straight drop, a little more protection. Wheel the halfback out. It is caught out of bounds. Chad Hall's foot came down out of bounds on the sideline, according to the official, and it's a punt for Air Force.
Another good call by the officials. Watching it in real speed, Mike, it looked like he might have gotten the left foot down, but I think when his foot came down, it was right on the line. And in college football, it does not matter if you are pushed out of bounds. Comes down right on the line.
Correct call and well played by Jamal Hall, the defensive back, because as you said, force out doesn't count. 71 was the last punt by Donnie Heaton. This one not as far, and climbing for the return. The ball comes out after Dustin Osborne was down, according to the officials. Marker down as well. Boy, they are in so many tough situations here. Bang, bang plays. I don't see the flag down the field, so maybe it was just a towel that dropped out of somebody's equipment as they were running. Yeah, there is no flag. So it will be Air Force ball at the 32. CSU back on the field. Their top pass-catch combination of Holland and Anderson to work when you come back. Bomb, the play was reviewed to see if it was a fumble or not a fumble. The ball's going to stay with Colorado State from everything we saw. And we'll get the official announcement from Scott Novak here momentarily. Here's a peek at what he saw as you hear him make the call.
After review, the ruling on the last play stands as called. It'll be first down.
Lucky that you can't go back and give a 15-yard flag.
I said, can you review a late hit? Because he was down. There wasn't any question about the fumble. It was just a couple of the Air Force cover guys. They got in there a little bit late.
So back Justin Holland and the Colorado State offense come. There has not been a lot of running. So Kyle Bell continues to be stymied here. Here's what Kirk was talking about.
Yeah, he's down, and there's one, and bang! Here's number two. You got the cup on there on that second one.
Excuse me.
That one hurt there a little bit. Watch yourself.
Andy Gray in there on the hit. Gain of one for Bell, second and nine. Holland back to the air. Pressure on him. The throw for Anderson. Nice job of not going out of bounds. Getting about 13 more yards out of the play to the 40. First down, gain of 27. David Anderson continues to climb up the all-time reception chart.
Justin Holland continues to make the throws, and it's because his advantage out on the outside. He's got a receiver and a group of receivers that can make plays. Great effort here by Anderson to be able to get away from coverage. Sutton not only leaves him open, but then doesn't make the tackle in the open field. That's something that Fisher DeBerry talked about last week, the week before, and tonight. They've got a tackle, but great throw by Holland.
Anderson, five catches for 77 yards. Holland getting near 250 yards. As he completes another one to the 31-yard line, Luke Roberts. And let's get an update from our studio in Reese Davis. Reese?
Mike, our singular All-America Player of the Week, the fine running back from the Minnesota Golden Gophers, Lawrence Maroney, 46 carries, 217 yards against Purdue. You can vote for the singular All-America Player of the Week. Just text VOTE to 87654 on your singular wireless phone to make your voice heard, and you could win a trip to the national championship game. Lawrence Maroney, singular All-America Player of the Week.
Don't need to tell that to the folks here in Fort Collins. Minnesota ran roughshod over the Colorado State defense in their game a couple of weeks ago. Injured player for Air Force is Russ Mitschteerling, who was injured coming into last week, didn't play at all because of a left ankle injury. Didn't start, but did play a little bit here this week. And looking at Russ's left leg again. Mentioned Minnesota, Kirk, and what Reese was talking about. Minnesota ran it on Colorado State 59 times for 355 yards.
Well, I think Minnesota is going to be running the football on a lot of teams this year, and Lawrence Maroney gets a lot of credit, and he's going to be a player you're going to watch on Sunday for a long time. But, Mike, I think it has as much to do with Glenn Mason and his offensive linemen and what they're doing. What a great scheme that Minnesota has year after year when it comes to running the football.
You see Russ coming off the field. Minnesota goes to Penn State. A pair of 4-0 teams meeting this week. Here's the injury to Mitschteerling. He's up top of his screen. You see him going down.
Valiant effort just to be out there. Yep. Just trying to go, considering he is banged up with the left ankle. But Justin Holland right now is on fire. Eight of his last nine, 182 yards and two scores.
Colorado State on the move. Ball at the 30. Halfway through and a penalty marker down in this third quarter. Make another point about Minnesota here after this.
Dead ball. Ball start. Offense. Number 64. 5-yard penalty. First down.
Nicolata has two of the three penalties in this game for Colorado State. Air Force has not been penalized here tonight. Sonny Lubick mentioned it. Another coach mentioned it to me. I think you said somebody else mentioned it to you, how good it is to watch Minnesota and what a fun watch they are, how they block, how they run the ball offensively, and that they are a team to be reckoned with. As in past years, it was a soft early schedule. This year, there's a lot more legitimacy to it.
Well, the big, big win over Purdue, I think, brought that legitimacy.
Game of three there. We just talked about Lawrence Maroney, who's getting all the audits, and rightfully so.
But like I said, Glenn Mason, his background is an offensive line coach. So no matter where he's been, he's always had great offensive linemen and great offensive line play. The scheme is terrific. And then they do a great job of recruiting. Marion Barber III, Lawrence Maroney, Russell, the young back that they have, who's done a great job, has shown when he gets in there, he can run. It's going to be good to see Penn State's defense at home 4-0 against Minnesota running the football. Brian Cupido, in my opinion, is going to have to make some plays for Minnesota to win that game.
Pressure off the corner. Here comes Carson Bird trying to get to Holland. Didn't get there. Pass should have been caught. Incomplete for Johnny Walker. That's his third should have had it of the night. And that's one of those perfect quarterback throws. That throw was out before he made his break.
Well, that's one of the other things I've noticed from Justin Holland is he likes to get rid of the football well before the receiver turns. The one thing I would say that when Justin Holland looks at the tape is sometimes when you have a tendency as a quarterback when you're going to throw all the way back to the left is he opened up almost too far and it caused the ball to go to a little bit far. Of course the receiver could have made a catch, but the way he's throwing the ball tonight, he opened up a little bit too far and it caused the ball to go closer to the sideline.
Tougher catch as you looked at it on replay. Third and 13, pressure in his face, got rid of it, incomplete. Good job by Air Force there. They've been bringing so much corner pressure, they come up the middle that time. And they get to Holland and force the punt. Grant Thomas, who's in the game after the Mitch Cheerling injury, helps force this punt.
What a play by Grant Thomas, 275 pounds. He's on a stunt move to try to rush the quarterback, and by the time he realizes what's happening, Hall or Bell is going right by him to the flat for a screen, and he had the pretty good job of just observing the play and reacting and getting out there to try to deflect that pass away.
Jimmy Kaler, the punter, has popped a couple inside the 20. They are at their own 33. Would have been a 50-yard field goal from here. We'll try to run it down, take a delay, a game penalty. And have five more yards of operating room. Fisher DeBerry going to take it or decline it?
Delay a game on the offense. 5 yards, fourth down.
Mitch Cheerling, the lineman injured earlier on that series. Very important stop there for Air Force, I thought. Colorado State gaining good momentum in the passing game. Nice job to get off the field.
I think it almost starts, it's starting to get that feel here in the second half. Whichever defense could come up with a big stop, it's going to be crucial.
Not a good snap. Good job by Kaler to bring it down. And Colorado State could not down it. So it's a touchback. Come back out to the 20. Only a net of 18 yards. And while we're talking about the Big Ten, how about this game in East Lansing? Drew Stanton and the Sparties, oh, they're feeling their oats. The Big Blue is wounded coming up to play Michigan State.
I think if you have a Heisman vote at this point, you have to have Drew Stanton up in your top four or five. Almost you have to. The guy has been absolutely incredible. The thing that I've loved about Drew Stanton is the leadership that he's provided for Michigan State. It's not just the numbers are terrific, but for Michigan State to play the way they did against Illinois, there's something different about this Michigan State team. They've always had talent, but now they have leadership, and I think he has as much to do with that as anybody.
Quarterback change, Adam Fitch comes in, and Courtney Jones is stopped right away for no gain. And an Air Force Falcon was slow to get up. So they went to Adam Fitch last week, not because of injury, but because Sean Kearney, it was the time when he needed a little bit of a spark, and boy, Fitch brought it to them. got the team back from down 17 to within three. So they bring the young man from Wyoming in. Carney's there on the sideline with Jacoby Kendrick. And they just react to the replay they just saw of that big hit as Lawrence Hufford, the left guard, is shaken up. We go back to the Washington game at the start of the season. They brought in the second team offense and really gave him a spark.
Ooh. Yeah, came right down on top of the leg.
The residual of the Courtney Jones hit. He tried to work himself off the field, but Ryan Williams rolling up on him just couldn't do it. Lawrence, the left guard, one of the seniors. He'll work his own way off the field.
Mike, the thing you started to talk about, Adam Fitch, and what he provides is not just a spark, but he's more of your traditional option Air Force quarterback. And he's a veteran. He's been around. His players seem to respond to him when he's in there.
Out to the 24-yard line. Tyler Dohalo, by the way, came in at left guard for Hufford, and this Air Force offense will face third and about five and a half. That comfort factor goes to the players, to the coaches also. And when Fitch came in, I was a little surprised how they brought Fitch in a situation where they needed to get points quickly and throw the ball. But he did everything well against Utah coming back from down 17.
Made some big throws. He scrambled around, ran the option, made good reads. He was everything you would have asked for your backup quarterback.
Third and six, and Fitch will run it. A designed run, able to miss three would-be tacklers, get the first down past the 30. That is one thing he does a little bit better than Sean Carney.
Well, he made up his mind, and this looked like a play that was designed to get him out and into the open field, but Jesse Nading, number 59, made a good read here, and Jesse Nading has a chance to right there make the play, but Fitch outruns him and then continues to go on to pick up the first down. Nading has the angle. And if I'll tell you, if that's Sean Carney, Air Force is punting.
Air Force had only picked up one of the previous nine third downs. But they did pick up a few fourth downs. So Air Force third down conversions more misleading than it can be for other teams at times. There's Fitch trying to dance to the outside. Show a little bit of what makes him valuable, and Aaron has more on the quarterback.
Yeah, I talked to Adam Fitch before the game. I asked him, what's his mindset? How does he stay focused while Sean Carney is in? And he said, it's team philosophy. I abide by Fisher DeBerry's rules every day, every play, even when I'm not in there. Asked him how he accepts the role he's in. He said, I've never once regretted the decision I made to stay and play here, and he credits his father. He says, my dad taught me everything about patience.
He's a senior, Aaron, and had to be frustrated because usually, as we mentioned in the first half, freshmen don't come in and become the starting quarterback at Air Force. When Carney did it last year, it was the first time since Dee Dowis, remember that name in Air Force lore, back in 1986. Here he is again, keeping on the option. About 3.5, 4 yards shy of the first down. Jeff Hrinek, the freshman, made the tackle.
Kurenik, considering this is the first time he's seen triple option, he's been all over the field making plays, and Air Force continues to come at them with a triple option, and Kurenik has been all over the field, and a lot of times being right where he needs to be to take the quarterback away.
He's from Atwood, Kansas, population 1,242. Spent a lot of his time on the farms in western Kansas with family and neighbors, getting alfalfa and other crops ready for harvest time. Third and three. Miscommunication on the throw as it's incomplete. And Kirkwood's still running.
That's the one thing that you see, whether it's triple option or it's Tennessee with what was going on with Ainge and Clawson, or no matter who it is, sometimes the communication with a quarterback and his group of receivers when he comes in there for that first or second possession. Kirkwood, who's been in the game the entire time, is reading a certain coverage off of Robert Herbert. And the quarterback, Adam Fitch, saw something else. Poor communication there.
Donnie Heaton to kick again. No fair catch was made. And now a flag comes down at the 21-yard line. Seemed like a fair catch. Everything felt like a fair catch. It was high, it was short, and the hit was made.
After the play, personal foul on a kicking team, number 10. 15 yards out of the end of the run. First down.
First major penalty against Air Force.
Last 2 weeks,
they were mostly flag free.
Yeah, you have to take a look, but you know, that's a good call. I mean, you're not going to see that very often from an Air Force team. Great coverage. And again, special teams has been a concern for Air Force throughout this season. I touched on something, and I just kind of stumbled into it. I just want to make sure that we say something, and that's about Tennessee. And you and I haven't been on the air since that game Monday night.
No, but we were on our phones Monday night.
We were
chatting
talking
about it. Yeah.
Rick Clawson, and what he did in that football game. I just want to stand up and applaud everything that he has been through, for him to be down and his team to be down 21-0. The coach to say, "Hey, we're going back to you. Go make the plays." What a unbelievable performance and salvage Tennessee's season.
Kyle Bell runs a yard shy of the first down with 2nd and 1 coming up as we get to the 3-minute mark. Boy, there was so much going on in that game, and you mentioned the Tennessee side. And for LSU, the emotion of the place as they ran out. Everything that was going on, and then just looking for that distraction away from the reality that has been the devastating month in Louisiana. They're up 21 and things are going great, and then Tennessee drive. LSU losing its grasp of the game, and just the devastation on the faces of people far more insignificant than what's happened to their homes and their lives and uprooting families. But they just were looking to grasp onto something positive, and it wasn't there. Bell broke out of 2 tackles and a third, and he takes it to the 25-yard line. First down, gain of 29 yards. So now Colorado State's getting something out of the running game.
Well, that's what you can look forward to seeing, not only the rest of this year, but for years to come from Colorado State's offense. Kyle Bell provides this, and this is the offense that you can, you think about Colorado State, and this is what you think about. A stretch play, it's a zone play. All you have to do is you have to have vision. If you're going to be a running back and play at Colorado State, you have to be able to find that cutback lane and have a feel for it, and Kyle Bell has that and the power to break tackles.
Bell now over 100 yards tonight, 21 carries, 107 yards. Back to the run, the center Bimper was trying to pull for him, and he only gets a couple of yards. Well, as you watch your football this weekend, we're talking about Tennessee and Michigan State. So much important action going on. October's first Saturday, you can watch 15 games and online too. ESPN.com, keyword game plan, or get the game plan portion from your cable operator, your pay-per-view provider. More information, Michigan State, if that's not the ABC game in your area, USC, Arizona State, if that's not the game in your area, dial it up on game plan. And Chris Fowler, Lee Corso will be with Kirk for game day in Tempe this week. Anderson, holding it, great grab, touchdown. Rocket shot from Justin Holland.
Mike, Justin Holland and David Anderson remind me of a quarterback and a receiver who have played a lot of football together away from Sonny Lubick's field and Sonny Lubick Stadium here in Colorado State, because they have just that instinct, that sixth sense of, I know what you're seeing, you know what I'm feeling, let's make it happen. And when you have the accuracy and the arm strength that Holland has, this Holland has paid his dues. He's a veteran that's been around as a senior. This is an important game to him to go up against Air Force, but the football is thrown exactly where it has to be. And watch Anderson, nice route, little move. The defensive back, Sutton, doesn't really have a chance because a little bit of a stem move. Once he turns his back, the ball is thrown before the move is what I really appreciate from Justin Holland.
He's not Bradley Van Pelt, but as Sonny Lubick said, he's as accurate as anyone in the country. And when I say he's not Bradley Van Pelt, who was the quarterback here for a few years and now the backup down the road in Denver, Van Pelt did so many different things. Holland's more pure drop back, I'm in the pocket, get it and throw it. And if you build your offense around a guy like that, and there are the two guys who've hooked up six times. So there you go. What about me? What about Aaron?
Hey,
come on.
hey, Mike, we're talking a lot about Holland, and he's making great throws. But the gem rat, David Anderson, went up there effortlessly as well and made a great catch to bring that in for another touchdown for Colorado State.
Touchback, ball comes out to the 20-yard line. I like that term to describe. That's what he is. It's really like a gym rat.
For college quarterbacks and for high school quarterbacks, most important thing is to have the ability to eventually get to this. Matt Leinart has this. There's a few guys that have this ability. But I want you to watch the quarterback and when he throws the football. Ball's gone right as the receiver makes his initial cut to the inside. He's not waiting until the receiver's open. He knows that the receiver's going to be at a certain spot, and he throws it to that spot because of that feel with David Anderson.
So Air Force's inability to score touchdowns in the red zone in the first half now really making an impact. Colorado State's defense is fired up. But the offense is done. Chad Hall going to lose a couple of yards here. Horinick, Jamal Hall, Lucas Davis, the backup safety, all making plays.
Safeties are flying up. Lucas Davis, you think he's concerned about any play action or anything else? Option, I've got the pitch coming downhill, forces it back to the inside, and there is a defense pursuing, flying to the football, defending this option from the inside out at this point.
And interesting, Davis has been on a couple of series. Coach Avery's been out, and that safety spot's so important against option. He's done a nice job. Here's the option. You saw him coming from the start, and the inability of Hall to cut back and make the play. Great shot, guys, because you were locked in on Davis diving down that alley, as Kirk was describing earlier.
Mike, here's another example of stopping the option. Quarterback comes down the line. Garcia is right here. He's going to come right up to take away the quarterback, and now here comes the safety. Already knows the ball is going to be pitched. And here he comes downhill, making a play. Turns his shoulders a little bit, but he's coming so fast to try. That's where we showed Oklahoma a little bit earlier and what they had. How you could pitch it to the outside to a Billy Sims or a Marcus Dupree and down the sideline. Air Force doesn't have that luxury. That's why these safeties can pin their ears back and chase down the halfbacks.
I know Colorado State has the momentum. Air Force, on 11 possessions this year in the fourth quarter, has scored 7 touchdowns. So they're not out of it yet. But they've got to make something happen as we get to quarter four, down 11. Off we go to the fourth quarter of college football primetime, presented by Cooper Tires, with Aaron Andrews and Kirk Herbstreit, Mike Tirico. Colorado State leading by 11. Air Force has been a fourth quarter team all season long. They'll need their best in the final frame to avoid a third conference loss. Third and 9, flag down. Fitch threw it complete to Brown in the middle. First down, if it stands, at 36. It was thrown right where holding usually happens.
Well, is there tackling?
Yes, there is.
I mean, is there offensive tackling, or is that just a hold?
Holding. Offense.
I'm kidding.
Number 56. 10-yard penalty. Third down.
I mean, Sandy's helmet coming off was a...
I don't think the helmet came off, but it was really good technique for just an open field tackle.
56 was mentioned. That's John Wilson, the center. Don't know if it was John or if it was the man next to him, 65.
It's right in the middle of the screen.
Yep, it was
John, right? There. Bringing it down.
And then the helmet did come off on the back end of that. Well, Air Force's offense usually is not built to convert third and 19. And again, Adam Fitch, the second string quarterback in there for the second straight series, drop back and throw deep downfield. Kirkwood streaking open, and he couldn't get it to him. Wow. The defender fell down. Kirkwood had a lot of real estate, but they just could not connect.
Lucas Davis, we've been talking about so much and what he's been able to do, and coming up against the option is right on the hash at the bottom of the screen, slips. And when he slips, if that ball is thrown accurately, it's probably a touchdown for Kirkwood and Air Force, which is the break they need right now, with now that we're into this fourth quarter.
Donnie Heaton had a 70-yarder earlier. He will kick it with the wind. Tumbling line drive, tough to catch. Hauled in eventually by Walker. Big hit on Donnie. Colorado State ball at the Air Force 45, Sports Center 30 and 30, and here's Reese Davis.
All right, Mike, some high drama for the Red Sox. Red Sox taking on Toronto. Big copy in the ninth with two men on, and Ortiz delivers again. Earlier, he had tied the game with his 47th home run, and the Red Sox beat the Blue Jays in the ninth 5-4. They are one game behind the Yankees in the East. Those two teams will square off 2 out of 3, perhaps for the Red Sox over the weekend, and we'll have a playoff game on Monday. Red Sox and Yankees on ESPN Friday night, by the way, guys.
Thank you, Reese. All the news now on ESPN News. SportsCenter follows the game. What a finish at Fenway. The run by Bell on first down for about 5. Aaron Andrews will be leaving us and red-eyeing after the game to Boston for that great series. She'll join Dave O'Brien and Rick Sutcliffe, I believe. Is that right?
For the EA. I don't know if I've ever seen EA as fired up for a sporting weekend as I've seen her these last couple days.
It's a big deal, guys. You got A-Rod, Big Poppy, a home run tonight. Huge.
The captain.
All the drama you need.
The captain's going to be playing too, right?
Okay. Well, you know.
Veritek, he's an important
David
part of
Wells
that.
David pitching, so Veritek does catch him. No Doug Mirabelli. Tim Wakefield.
She is ready. Bell with the carry. Yard and a half shot.
Go try.
The first down.
Go try.
Indians, well, any game that matters on Sunday, by the way, we have for you on ESPN. It's going to be a great baseball weekend. All right, Herbie, Home Depot coaching adjustments in this final quarter.
Well, Air Force is down 11, and we've seen them never give up. And this is a team that's going to continue to fight. They're going to go deep. They've got to get Jason Brown and Kirk with the football. We almost just saw that. And then for Colorado State, run the football, run the football. And then I still would eventually, if they're going to try to load up at the line of scrimmage, this game is still in doubt. Throw the football downfield to Holland to David Anderson.
Third and a couple. They'll run Bell. Climbs through. Almost took it the distance. Couldn't climb out of Bobby Giannini's arm tackle. Gain of 7. First down for Kyle Bell, who's now approaching a buck and a quarter rushing here tonight.
It's a nice offense. I mean, they've got a great scheme, nice balance, big, strong offensive line, and I think they found a running back. When they came into this year, I think they felt O'Hare would be their guy, with the speed merchant who transferred in from UCLA. But to be honest, I think they'd rather have a physical presence at the tailback position, and that's what they're going to have now with Kyle Bell.
Bell works it to the right. 20, 15, 10, 5 and in. Touchdown, 30 yards, Kyle Bell.
You know, just when you think he is a power back, he's got enough of a burst there that when he does make a cut and get to the open field, he's got enough speed to be able to get into the end zone.
Take him up to 154 yards on the night. Kevin Mark adds the extra point. 21 unanswered for Colorado State. And they're celebrating Fort Collins. Out of Keensburg here in the state, the sophomore Kyle Bell makes it an 18-point lead for the home team.
ESPN's College Football Primetime is presented by Cooper Tire's Ultimate Bowl Tour. Go to a Cooper dealer near you or visit ultimatebowltour.com to enter. And in part by Waste Management, from everyday collection to environmental protection. Think green. Think Waste Management.
4 touchdowns the last 5 possessions. Colorado State 34-16 over the Air Force Academy. And here's Bell.
You're right. Offensive line.
helping out Kyle Bell tonight.
Major league running back brownie points there, huh?
Smart.
Greg Kirkwood on the return. Slips and slides down at the 20. So that's 330 plus yards last 2 weeks.
Well, Kyle Bell is right. He's got offensive linemen that have worked hard tonight, but let's face it, he's made some big plays. And he has shown, I think you can see his confidence growing. This is a young running back as a sophomore. Last week, he had 183 yards against Nevada, career best. Now he follows it up tonight with a great performance so far of 154. You're watching a young running back gain more and more confidence, and he's very, very smart to point to that offensive line to let them know how much he appreciates their efforts here, these not only tonight, but also last week.
Sean Kearney comes back in the game at quarterback. They had just led a three-play 80-yard drive. Then the next one after that, we saw Adam Finch come in. And those two drives, Air Force hasn't done much. Now they find themselves in arrears by 18. Twisted around is Kearney after the gain of five. Jamal Hall, out of Fort Worth, made the tackle with Courtney Jones. There's Finch back on the sideline.
It's hard to criticize the way Air Force has used their quarterbacks just because it's a lot of times it's worked out this year.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. The Washington game worked, and last week it worked.
Yep. I mean, you might think, geez, why did they go to Finch? I mean, why isn't Kearney in there? He could throw the football, but...
It's a field thing, and that's why it's worked. First down gained as Coach Shaver makes the tackle at 32.
So one aspect of this option game just is missing at this point with Air Force. And I know they're down, but the quarterback is effective. The fullback, I think, is effective. The running back spot is the one area that you just love to see an upgrade.
Just a little more burst.
A little bit more speed to be able to get to the perimeter, get to the corner. I mean, we've seen some runs tonight by Hall and Smith, but overall, that's just a little bit of a burst. And a more of a threat out there is what they, I think, are missing.
Kearney down the line to toss. They got one of the halfbacks out of the backfield, and they've been this close to hitting it in three or four plays tonight. That was Chad Smith, scored a touchdown earlier tonight. If you're just joining us, it was out of the gate 7-0 in favor of Colorado State when Bell scored his first touchdown. Air Force kicked three field goals from Eberle, hit at 9-7 right at the end of the half. Colorado State was one play away from being forced to punt with about a minute left. They picked up the first down. Three passes later, they're in the end zone. 13-7 at the half, but no, Air Force walked right down the field. Three plays, 80 yards, took a lead. Since then, three consecutive Colorado State drives for touchdown. Another open receiver, Kirkwood, can't haul it in from Kearney, who's missed his last five passes.
Kearney's upset, but I tell you, Mike, he is not, he's just not been able to find any kind of rhythm tonight throwing the football from the very beginning of the game.
Now, in other years, we've seen that stat, and that's typical Air Force. There have been times when they don't throw the ball at all and are still successful. This year, their balance has been there when they've won games. They've had over 200 yards rushing and passing in a couple of their wins against Washington and San Diego State. Third and 10, there's one to Kirkwood across midfield into the 46-yard line. Tommy Hill, the defensive lineman, came off the line to make the tackle after a gain of 22.
Well, now there's the arm, and there's the accuracy that you expect to see from Sean Kearney. What I was a little bit surprised by was how deep the Colorado State corners, how soft they were playing, and it gave Kirkwood a real simple, wasn't real complex. He ran a little bit past the first down and had a curl route, and by the time he turned around, the ball was right in his face. Surprised they didn't stay up a little bit tighter, at least to the first down line.
Back to the air, looking long, breaking open is the halfback, Chad Hall, to the 14-yard line. First down, gain of 32, and Air Force getting yards in chunks here, still with plenty of time.
Interesting in what they tried to do here to try to get Hall free, because they have two receivers getting vertical right here, which is going to occupy the safety, and then you have Hall coming right to the outside. By doing that, it takes the corner completely away from the receiver who's going to end up making the play, which is Chad Hall. So they flooded the zone and then took the receiver and put him right into the middle of that spot.
Brown, the good receiver, lined up closest to you, tight to the line, goes out to be a receiver. He's triple covered, but underneath, it's open for the fullback, Williams, touchdown. Beautiful play design there. Beautiful play design. 34-22. You go for one here. You don't need the two on the first try.
Mike, what I'm surprised is that you're getting the fullback out in the flat. We haven't seen him out there, but this was 80 yards in 2 minutes. This is an option team that just went 80 yards in 2 minutes and 11 seconds. Fullback slides to the flat. Nobody covers him. Nobody covers him. It's something they've not shown the entire night. Confusion by Colorado State's defense the last two plays, and this time Sean Kearney and the Falcons are able to capitalize.
When you're down 18, you kick the extra point the first time around and then try to go for the two-point conversion with the touchdown if you get that last one.
Remember that time I said go for one?
Yeah.
And how it sometimes comes back to be interesting?
It always lurks around. It's like that friend who never leaves and you can't wait to show the door. Sean Kearney back on the field, ringing up a touchdown, keeping Air Force within contact. 10.5 remaining in regulation.
Quick score for Air Force. And it's very important to get points on the board as fast as they can, being down by 18. We've seen them here before. I mean, you know they're going to keep coming.
Great open field tackle. Ball came out after the return man. George Hill was down, the official says, at the 16-yard line. So it'll be a long field for Colorado State.
Mike, I think there's a poor communication. You're going to see the receivers just come down here, and actually the man who makes the play is going to come out here for the touchdown. I think the young man who made a mistake is Hurnick, the linebacker, because he gets a little bit confused with the play action. Now he starts to find the backside receiver, and by then there's nobody in the flat in man coverage to take the fullback, and I think Hurnick should have been all over him and followed him out to the flat.
Well, that Air Force offense, they banged off 68 yards the last three plays of that drive. Is this being reviewed? Usually when the umpire runs in that quickly, there's a clock or a review.
Previous play, yeah, is being reviewed.
If you don't remember from last year, a couple of officials wear a pager-type buzzer, get buzzed from upstairs in the replay booth. Well, they have a TiVo-type unit and watch all the plays. And that's clearly the ground causing it on the tack.
Hill's been involved in a few things tonight where the ball has come out. The one time he was lined up as a tailback and mishandled a Justin Holland, just a draw play, a simple handoff. But this time, the ground cannot cause the fumble, so the play will stand. Colorado State will retain possession, up 11 with 10 minutes to go.
Just give you the numbers again that Craig Thompson dropped off for us.
But you got to add the numbers.
No, I can't add tonight. Too much has happened tonight.
We've had a lot of
3,100 plays, 25 stoppages, even split between the replay booth saying check the replay and 12 coaches throwing the red flag, as you can only do in the Mountain West. Of the 25 stoppages, only 8 have been only overturned. So a third of the plays have been overturned. Mostly, the plays have been called correctly.
After review, the ruling on the field stands as called. It'll be first down, Colorado State.
You know, another thing Craig mentioned when he stopped by is 6 conference games, 5 of them decided by 3 points or less. TCU, 2 wins in overtime. Some overtime replay controversy in their win last week.
How about the Horned Frogs?
That was on one of the screens in the bus?
Yeah, made screen five, lower right on the Home Depot bus for game day.
First and 10 from the 16-yard line for Holland. Bell, big touchdown run last drive. Just grinds out about 7 to open this drive.
Well, Fowler trying to get tennis 1 week off.
What?
One of the settles.
Yeah. Speaking of college game day, it'll start your Saturday, which is punctuated by Virginia Tech, West Virginia, and Notre Dame, Purdue. The primetime game presented by Polaroid, also available like tonight on ESPN HD. Brady Quinn and crew in West Lafayette at 7:45 Eastern time. We just pencil in Jeff Samardzija for like 6 catches and 100 yards.
And
every day.
Oh yeah, that's a given. See, Purdue and Brock Spack can shore up that defense, that run defense.
2nd and 4. Different look of the play. Same result as Bell starts to sniff 200 yards as he's taken all the way shy of midfield to the 48-yard line. 26, Matt Caron. And he's up to a buck 86 on the night.
Mike, he just continues to get better and better. He's wearing the offensive line's doing a good job of wearing people down, but boy, what a nice looking running back Kyle Bell is. He's not only, Mike, just a big physical back, like we keep referring to Cecil Sapp of a few years ago and Kevin McDougal, but one thing you're going to see with Kyle Bell is he's got a burst and he's got some athletic ability. He'll pull away from defenders, as you saw him just hurdle a defender coming in low.
Had his career high 183 yards Saturday against Nevada. Eclipses that tonight with 186. Now the boot and the throw complete. The tackle's missed, and breaking into the secondary is Luke Roberts. Pick it up, blocks. Roberts punt at the 16-yard line. That's 36 yards, and Colorado State moving in on 500 on this Air Force defense here tonight.
Absolutely love the call by Dan Hammerschmidt, the offensive coordinator. First and 10, you're thinking, oh, they've got a nice lead. Let's kill the clock. Air Force decides to blitz. Justin Holland, terrific job of being ready to throw the football, coming off of the naked with the blitz, makes the play, and I think they found another receiver tonight in Luke Roberts. Luke Roberts comes up, makes the play, breaks a tackle, and if Sperry would have made a block, he's in the end zone.
Sperry's blocking now for Bell. Kyle takes it to the 9-yard line. Give him 6 on that carry. That is 142 of his 193 yards coming here in this second half.
There are different ways that coaches go about coaching when they have a lead, and I'm not saying one way is right or the other, but I know when you're a defense, puts a lot of pressure on you when a coach is willing to take a little bit of a risk, play action, trying to catch him off guard. This time it happened to work out for Colorado State and turned out to be a big play.
Well, the big part of that was on first down.
Exactly.
You know, and it wasn't third and three and you wait for it.
Right.
Where you kind of can sniff it a little bit. Bell trying to stretch it out. Can't get back to the original line. Maybe he did. Well, third and four. You mentioned Dan Hammerschmidt, 87 alum of Colorado State. He's been around a while. I don't think Sonny Lubick has done. And without the resources that other schools have to retain assistant coaches, he continues to have a very good staff of young assistant coaches. Assistant coaches have been in this program, worked their way up. Hammerschmidt's got the opportunity to be the offensive coordinator the last few years, running a very good system here. We'll take a timeout halfway through this fourth quarter. Colorado State timeout. Be back with their 3rd and 4 right after this. Halfway through the final quarter, we have 3rd and 4 coming up for Colorado State. Looking to improve its record here on the season to 2-2 and get a win in the conference opener. 3rd and 4. Bell is the only back. He has 192 yards on the night. The throw back to Anderson, who eludes two, works his way through, and might have picked up the first down. What an effort by David Anderson, the senior out of Westlake Village in Southern California. Got Breisel and others blocking for him. We have an injured Colorado State player on the play.
Mike, how did he get the first down?
He did pick it up. Albert Bimper shaking up.
He's trying to get back behind. Ooh.
Yeah, is that not a block in the back?
Yeah, he's trying to get behind Breisel.
Wow. Bimper, the center out of Arlington, Texas. Got rolled up on here. One of those games where there's been no stopping at any play tonight. Everybody trying to play it to the last echo of the whistle, hustling. Bimper just caught up there.
Usually when you see the big linemen get hurt, a lot of times it is either in pass protection or blocking downfield where they're a little bit away from the play and somebody rolls up on top of their leg.
So Nicolotta, the left guard, going to take some snaps here with the quarterback Holland down by the 5 in a first and goal situation. a lot is playing because of the injury to Brandon Alcansell, senior. It would take Bimper a long time to get off the field here as he's very slow to move. Payne Stratton, the new lineman, is going to come in the game. I remind you that SportsCenter is going to come up as soon as we're done. Scott Van Pelt and Neil Everett settle in a little bit. At a great final weekend of baseball battle, the Yankees, the Red Sox, the Indians, two will go. Talk about USC, they have an next great wide receiver, and why nothing will stop Donovan McNabb battling through injury. Well, those of you just joining us, our game track takes you through the night for Justin Howland, the quarterback with a big arm, 318 yards, three touchdowns. He's been dialed in with David Anderson, who has over 100 yards, two receivers over 100, and add Kyle Bell, 30 for a buck 92. His career best night, Colorado State. Taking it to an 11-point lead. Life-size Sonny Lubick. Taken from some dorm room to be returned in an hour, I would guess. First and goal. Toss, Bell. Looking for a block to set up, and just a wave of white shirts for the Falcons, pushing them back.
Like you hope that Albert Bemper is going to be okay for games coming up down the road, because Bemper as a senior is one of the veterans up there, and one of the more unusual things you'll see is he actually pulls. That's tough for centers to do. It tests your athletic ability, and well over 300 pounds for him to make the snap and then to have to get around the corner and lead Kyle Bell is pretty impressive. And he's done that tonight. And I don't know how many different linemen who have to play center could actually do that.
Quick toss, Bell. Lots of room to the end zone. Touchdown. Touchdown of the night for Bell, and that should be just about enough for those interested here this evening.
It's a play we're seeing more and more of, even in the NFL.
Yeah, you're right.
A little reverse and then pitch it the other way. The idea to take advantage of a defense that's overflowing, of being overly aggressive.
All the speed that's on the defensive side.
Yeah, and the Air Force right now is trying to take away whichever way they're going. And boy, Kyle Bell, what a night tonight. Close to 200 yards, and Colorado State is rolling.
These guys again, baby.
And 380 yards of rushing for Bell the last here 5 days. And it's fun when you're running back in the second half, you're getting all those carries. The only negative part for Colorado State right now is Albert Bimper, their senior center out of Arlington, Texas. He's very slow coming off the field. You're going to have to take him off via the vehicle after his left leg was rolled up upon earlier in this drive. Colorado State next plays back here against Utah a week from Saturday. They've got the toughest part of their Mountain West schedule. Bang, 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 six in a row. The lead is 18 here as we close in on 6 minutes. It's the third time we've seen an Air Force player slip. We've also got a penalty marker thrown during the Jim Aulis return for Air Force. Colorado State scored 5 touchdowns in the last 6 possessions. This Air Force defense that has given up 38 last week, 29 the 2 weeks before that, doesn't have the defensive number going in the right direction. 41 here tonight.
Well, in a conference where they can also throw the football, you look down the rest of their schedule and teams that they're going to be playing.
For Air Force, you mean?
Yeah, I'm sorry, for Air Force. Yeah. And the schedule that they have, and and the way they can throw the football in the Mountain West, it's their secondary is definitely their Achilles heel.
They still play both service academies, Army and Navy, and always an important thing for Fisher DeBerry's team is to win the Commander-in-Chief trophy.
Offside on a kicking team, blocking the back on a receiving team, penalties offset, re-kick.
Navy has won the Commander-in-Chief trophy each of the last 2 years. This is the first time that Air Force has gone back-to-back years without winning it since 1982. And for those of you who don't remember, that is the round robin between the three Division I A service academies, Army, Navy, and Air Force. This year, the Naval Academy will come out to Colorado Springs. That's the next game, a week from Saturday, and then Air Force will go to West Point on November 5th. And that is one of the reasons that Fisher DeBerry's long run has been so admired in a conference that has been better than the conference play that Army and Navy has seen over the last few years. Air Force has done that, dominated the head-to-head rivalry. Although this is really in the last 20 years, and you almost want to say going back, since this is the 50th year of Air Force football, about as good as it has been at all three service academies at the same time. Bobby Ross and Army looked good against Iowa State, and Navy's had a role in the last couple of years as well. Navy 0-2, lost to Maryland by 3 and Stanford by 3.
That Army game last weekend was terrific. You gotta wonder if that was Iowa State peeking ahead and looking at the big game in Lincoln this weekend, or if I think it was a combination of Army also playing really well.
Chad Hall had it deflected to Greg Kirkwood. A flag is down. That may have been a forward pass, but it's still a pretty sweet highlight as Kirkwood goes all the way for the touchdown. Somewhere a Buffalo Bills fan is saying, where was that official when Frank Wycheck was on the business end of the Kevin Dyson pass back in the playoffs in the late 90s, the Music City Miracle? The ball was thrown from the 14, right about to the 14, and they're discussing right now if it was a forward pass or a backward pass. And guess what? This, too, would be reviewable.
What a great play,
legal
though.
Forward pass on a receiving team. Penalized 5 yards in the spot of the foul. First down.
And Fisher DeBerry is arguing that the ball was tipped, that it was heading...
It's at the 14.
As a lateral. It's heading backwards towards the 12, and then the deflection. You got to wonder, and once the ball's deflected, and it'd be interesting to see if either the red flag comes out or if there it gives you a really good idea that it's heading forward.
That's a great one, though. It's a, once it gets deflected, it still remains a forward pass or not. Forward pass is still a forward pass, whether it's deflected or not. Because when a forward pass is deflected, it's an incompletion.
Well, if they review it and they look at this video, I mean, he's touching the ball there at the 14 when he deflects the ball.
Well, Fisher DeBerry choosing not to coach his challenge that, which I would find curious if he wasn't sure. Meantime, it's a self-sack as, again, for the fifth time tonight, an Air Force ball carrier has slipped. Again, this is a great shot, guys. Great angle. You see it right down the line here. The ball is at the 14 as he throws it. It is deflected approximately the 15. You're not right down the line, so you can't tell. There's Carney taking it out to the 9-yard line. I'll go back to just the principle of if you're throw a quarterback and throwing a ball downfield, it's deflected at the line of scrimmage. It's a forward pass. So it's not where the guy eventually catches the ball, where the receiver did there.
Sure.
Still cute.
Oh, it's a great play. It's the speed by Kirkwood going down the sidelines. Great video there from the lower shot really showed it, that it was forward pass.
5 minutes left here in the fourth. Another player slips, although he was trying to recover as Carney's throw was behind Victor Thompson, who had his second catch of the season earlier, and Air Force goes a quick three and out here. And it looks like the night will be done for Justin Holland. Caleb Haney, the quarterback who had to start five times last year. They like Haney's ability, too. Colorado State's been set at quarterback for a while. They continue to bring in good players. Go back to Moses Moreno.
Yep, Matt Newton.
In addition to Bradley Van Pelt, now with the Broncos. Hasn't taken a snap. Been on their roster for 2 years. Backing up Jake the Snake.
Jake Plummer. Good for him.
Speaking of quarterbacks, Herb Street, what are these two that you'll see after you guys do game day in Tempe?
I can't wait to see Matt Leinart. First chance to see him in person with the offense and with the new scheme with Lane Kiffin and Steve Sarkisian. And Sam Keller is lighting up scoreboards. And very few teams have been able to put pressure on Sam Keller. And it's allowed him to sit back and distribute the football all over the place. But these two right now, not only in the Pac-10, but you could say nationally, we look back at the end of the year, these are going to be obviously Leinart, but Sam Keller, I think, is the real deal. He had the big bowl game last year and has picked up where he left off in that bowl game.
Hand off to the new running back. There's Namde O'Harry for the first time, and he'll run it to the 44-yard line. Yeah, Arizona State has scored 188 points in its first four games against Temple, LSU, Northwestern, and at Oregon State. So if you are not in the area, that's one of the four regional games on ABC. That's in the late window. Michigan State's in the early window. USC Arizona State, the feature game in the late window. If your local ABC affiliate's not carrying that game, you want it, dial up the ESPN game plan, ESPN.com keyword game plan. You can get it online in your computer.
Great weekend to check out the ESPN game plan, because there are some great games. Noon Eastern and 3:30 Eastern.
This is a really good weekend. And we talked earlier about the Minnesota-Penn State game, which will add some intrigue to it. There's, for some reason, pushing and shoving going on behind the play. But the ball was down and came out much later. We started to mention that Michigan State story, or game. We got a funny story on that for you. I'm in Ann Arbor this week, and at a coffee shop getting my triple, double latte, whatever deal we get.
Right. You get.
I get. You don't get that?
No. I drink orange juice.
Orange juice? Yeah. Did a good job at breakfast today. Breakfast was a killer. Great breakfast.
Yeah, we...
Third and four
for Haney.
I haven't
eaten since breakfast, actually.
Neither have I. Haney to the throw. He gets his first completion of the night. Matt Bartz, the tight end, takes it up to the 22-yard line. Pick up the first down. The CSU tries to add to this lead. So
you get the latte, coffee.
The whole deal, and I'm just reading the paper. And one, a grad assistant from Michigan walks in. And he walks out with two of these big containers of coffee. I said, well, what are you doing? You know, are they take away coffee making privileges once you're at 500 there in Ann Arbor? The power went out at the football office on Monday. So as if everything else hasn't gone wrong. You know, Michael Hart hasn't played for most of three games. Offensive line injuries. Two very close games, but losses to Wisconsin and Notre Dame. Games Michigan could have won, but people are saying, what's wrong with Michigan?
Now they get the coffee.
Power goes out when you're trying to grind and watch films. They had to turn back the clock. It's been tough for them.
It's been a tough year. The injuries, who would ever think that potentially Michigan starts the year 2-3? I mean, I think they're going to go into East Lansing. I think they're going to play hard. Yeah. I think at the end, Drew Stanton might just have too much firepower, but Michigan has too much pride in their program. And for them to take all this abuse locally, nationally, they're embarrassed. Their players, their seniors are embarrassed. I guarantee you they're going to come into this intrastate rivalry and give it everything they have. And they'll play probably their best game of the year. I just don't know if it's enough to beat this Michigan State team.
Post first down flag brings it back. Still first and 10 at the 36. Ridiculously short-minded people asking, what's wrong with Michigan? You can't be great every single year. Hey, how about this fact? Chris Felico does a great job with Brad Edwards, the rest of our research team in Bristol. We were talking this morning. When's the last time Nebraska, Oklahoma, and Michigan, all three, were not in the poll, was top 20, now top 25 at the same time? Remember the day? It was October 30th of 1967. Yep. The last time those three schools were not in the poll, and they're not here this week.
And Michigan takes it back a couple years, because I think it was 1969 for the other two. When you throw Michigan in there, which happened this week, it goes all the way back to 1967. Michigan's going to be back, but without Michael Hart, so much is on Chad Henne and making decisions. Matt Sequoy hasn't been there. Their offensive line has been banged up. You know, Lloyd Carr, I want to hear excuses, but
It is when you lose that much firepower off a team that wants to run the football, it's tough to be able to find any kind of rhythm right now.
Namdeo Harry with the carry there. Oh, third down coming up. Our Wrangler five-star players of the game. We got to share it here.
We have to share. Yeah. It's almost like when we get to Thanksgiving and we want to share the pie. Justin Holland and Kyle Bell, both guys. In fact, I wish I could yell down to Sonny that Kyle has 190. Is EA down there? Could she get to Sonny and let Coach know that Kyle Bell just needs 3 yards for 200? You got to get him. He's that close.
He's got a nice round 380 here for the last two games.
Yeah, that's true. 183 and 197. It's just, you don't want to get him to get too much too early, right?
Third and six. O'Harry taking it to the outside. Got to learn there. You slide that back and stay in bounds. The final minute of the game, you're winning by 18.
Yeah, you probably want to stay in bounds then. Yeah.
2-2.
We've got baseball
State
highlights to get to.
Yes, we do.
Scotty Van Pelt back there, you said?
And Scotty is back there with Neil Everett.
Neil!
Setting up the
aloha.
Bar. These guys will have all the highlights, all those baseball, but certainly reports as well. We will have our postgame extra over on ESPN News.
Always a classic over on ESPN.
Postgame extra.
Scotty Van Pelt, he's keeping the turtle pride up. Is he hanging in there with Coach Fridge?
Yep, Maryland.
Yeah.
Trying to keep its season going.
I think they're 2-2 right now.
That's right. In the ACC, 1-1 in the league. And by the way, Mr. Herbstreit.
We're going to start getting into the ACC on Thursday night.
Yeah, 4th-and-1, O'Harry will get the first down, and that will wrap it up. Is we will have ACC October here on Thursday nights. We start in Atlanta next week with Georgia Tech. We'll see Georgia Tech, NC State. We'll see Virginia Tech twice, Frank Beamer's team. Boston College in there as well. Maryland hosting Virginia Tech. So a good month of Thursday nights coming up.
Can't wait.
ACC October here on Thursdays.
It's always great to get into the ACC and see the speed and the depth of that conference. Some great matchups. Boston College, by the way, showed me a lot.
Winning at Clemson?
Yeah, went to Clemson with a backup quarterback and played well.
Good quarterback play. It's so important. We saw it tonight here with Holland throwing for 300 yards for Colorado State. 41-23 is our final number here tonight. Air Force will fall to 2-3. 1-3 in the league and out of the Mountain West race, while Colorado State will be 2-2 and win its Mountain West opener. And two great guys, Fisher and Sonny, with a greeting there at midfield.
Have a good weekend. You're off to Syracuse and Florida State. Enjoy yourself.
We'll be in Tallahassee.
Irish making his first trip into West Lafayette as a head coach. And the traditions of these two great universities going on down on the field as we prepare for kickoff.
So many years building a mystique. So many legends adding to the legacy. So many souls wanting to believe. Just one man to make believers of them all. A tall order. And so far, Charlie Weiss has delivered.
When we're in the huddle, you can look in each other's eyes and see the confidence. While we're out there, we just feel like we can't be touched.
For Notre Dame, every game is a renewal of a deep-rooted rivalry. This week's contest is no exception.
We have as good as a football team as Notre Dame, if not better. It's definitely going to be a dogfight.
Since 1896, the Fighting Irish and Boilermakers have battled, with Purdue taking the last two, including a sound beating in South Bend last year.
We're better than them. We beat them 41-16 last year in their own house. They come to our house, and I don't lose at home.
Every game for us is a big game, so everything on our mind right now is just Purdue.
Revenge and the next step in a revival inspire the Irish tonight.
Welcome to ESPN's College Football Primetime, presented by Polaroid. Tonight, the 13th-ranked Notre Dame Fighting Irish take on the 22nd-ranked Purdue Boilermakers. ESPN Saturday Night College Football is broadcast in high definition, presented by Phillips. And here come the Boilermakers.
everybody. Ron Franklin along with Bob Davey, and welcome to the great state of Indiana. And folks, we got some truly wonderful football weather for a change. It is cool, it is crisp, and two rivals that love to dislike each other. When you look at Notre Dame, Bob, I have to think, you know, a new coaching staff, the great anticipation, but quite frankly, I think that Irish eyes are smiling even more than they thought they would be at this juncture of the season.
Well, Ron, if you're a Notre Dame fan, you have to be excited for having a new system, a new staff. This season has gone about as well as you could have hoped. They are 3-1, but more important to me, they have set a foundation which gives them a chance to have a dynamic offense.
This past Wednesday, Bob and I and Holly had an opportunity to talk with the new head coach at Notre Dame, and I posed the question to him, what was the most pleasant surprise since arriving at South Bend? And he very quickly replied, my quarterback. He thinks that Brady Quinn has just been totally outstanding.
In my opinion, Brady Quinn has developed into a great quarterback. He's always had the tools. He's big, tough. He has a great arm. The difference this year, the scheme that Charlie Weiss has implemented, that has gotten him over the top. For Purdue, Brandon Kearse is an interesting guy. Because he is so big and athletic, Joe Tiller has actually added some option to the spread offense. He can also throw it. The question, is he accurate enough? Ron, every week it comes down to this. Which one of these quarterbacks can execute?
Bobby can feel the anticipation in the stadium. So we're going to take a break. We are very close to kickoff as the Boilermakers play host to the Fighting Irish of Notre Dame. ESPN College Football Primetime, brought to you by MasterCard. Log on to ESPN.com, keyword MasterCard, for the Fanatic Showdown. Russell Athletic, who has proudly outfitted 25 Heisman winners. Are you Russell material? And Taco Bell, think outside the bun. ESPN Saturday Night College Football is broadcast in high definition, presented by Phillips. Let's go down to the sideline and check with the third member of our crew. Here is Holly Rowe. Holly?
Well, thanks, Ron. Purdue is coming off a devastating loss last week to Minnesota in overtime. If you go back to last season, they had five games they lost by a combined 14 points. And Joe Tiller is getting tired of them not winning the close game. So this week he put together a tape called Fantastic Finishes to show them that Purdue traditionally has won the close games. He also put some new ones in so these kids can see themselves on video getting it done. He hopes if this one goes down to the wire, they'll be a little bit more motivated and know what's expected of them today.
You know, Holly, we all would like to see a great finish. Obviously, we don't care who wins, but Joe was trying to pump up his kids. You're exactly right, and show them their fantastic finishes. And we'll see tonight if it did take with his ball club.
And Joe has these Purdue fans a little bit spoiled, having gone to 8 straight bowl games. There was a time when Purdue didn't even play anyone in the Big Ten close for a certain period of time. So two ways to look at those close loss statistics.
Here's Brightus with the kickoff. Line drive. It's going to be taken by David Grimes. 15, 20, little bit of a corridor, and is tackled with a nice job on the special teams at around the 22-yard line. So it gives us an opportunity to talk about Brady Quinn. And we talked about him off the top of the telecast tonight, but in watching a lot of tape of him yesterday, Bob, he does many things extremely well.
And when you put that tape of the Notre Dame offense on, Ron, this guy jumps off that tape at you. He is a first-round draft choice, in my opinion, maybe right now with another year of eligibility left.
Powers, Neal, and Darius Walker are the setbacks. That's Fasano, the tight end. They throw back the other direction, and that's Stovall up the far sideline. He is going to take it out across the 35 to the 40, and that is a quick gain of 18 yards on the play. Here are the starting lineups for Notre Dame. Fasano, the tight end, he is a young man to keep an eye on tonight. Stovall on the other side, and he is the young fellow who just caught the pass for 18 yards. And you see Mark Labor, there are veterans. In fact, there are six seniors on this offensive line, four who start and two who are reserves. Labor with his 28th start this evening.
And that is the most experienced offensive line in Notre Dame history, Ron. These guys have played a lot of football.
Draw play. Here's Walker. Jumps over a tackler in the backfield, tries to turn the corner, and he's going to be stopped after a gain of maybe one right in front of an excited Purdue bench. Here are the starters on defense. The down for Brandon Villarreal out of Allen, Texas, just outside of Dallas, is one of the team leaders and a co-captain. Kyle Williams, only a freshman. The coaching staff really likes this young fella. And in the secondary, this is the way they'll start. Logan and Hickman at the corners. Bernard Parlow at strong safety, a real hitter. He'll come after you. Draw play. Walker right up the middle. Going to have 5 yards and fields his way for a couple of more. And it'll be third down, Notre Dame, and they will need a couple. George Hall there to make the stop. Santucci with a paving block.
As we look at Charlie Weiss, this Purdue defense has been outstanding over the last several years. 11 starters back from last year, but they've struggled early in this season, Ron, and none of the Purdue coaches can really put their finger on exactly why this defense has struggled.
Two tight end alignment, Fasano and John Carlson, and they will throw to either one. They're huge targets. Goes out to Stovall, and the pass is too tall. So Notre Dame will have to kick it away unless Charlie Weiss decides he's going to do some gambling at midfield to start this ball game.
We look at Charlie Weiss. Interesting, after over the last 2 years, talking again about this Purdue defense, they have knocked Brady Quinn down 48 times in 2 years, Ron.
Isn't that amazing?
And Brady Quinn, his first start in college football in this stadium 2 years ago.
Lance Melvin, the deep man, as you look at D.J. Fitzpatrick, they go under center. Are they just trying to draw him off sides? It appears that's exactly what he's trying to do. And Purdue's not buying any of this. Now listen to the crowd. And there comes the delay of game flag in, and the crowd applauded the patience of this special teams unit out on the field for not jumping offside.
Delay of game. Offense. 5 yard penalty. Fourth down.
And a big stop for the Purdue defense, a defense that a week ago, Ron, gave up 572 yards at Minnesota. Maybe a little confidence gained right here, first three and out.
Scott Redden is the long snapper. Fitzpatrick prepares to get it away, and here's his boot. Wobbly spiral toward the near sideline, and the bounce going to be taken on the run by Melvin. Melvin with a smart move getting ahead of that front wave of kick cover team and takes it out across the 35. So 32 on the kick and 13 yards on the return. Brandon Kirsch, Lebanon, Pennsylvania. And you see his major, leadership and supervision. And he needs a lot of both tonight, Bob.
He does tonight. And Joe Tiller, 8 years at Notre Dame. At Purdue. Drew Brees for 4 years. Kyle Orton for 4 years. Two NFL starting quarterbacks. Now it's Brandon Pierce's time.
From the shotgun, they go option. And the pitch to Boyd. Gerard Boyd has 5, has 10. Cut it off at about 14 yards on the first carry from scrimmage. And Boyd, the fifth-year man out of Clinton, Maryland, with the good pickup. Ingram, Dorian Bryant, and he's the real weapon. He's a speedster, 4-3. Ray Williams and Charles Davis making up the remainder of the specialist. Up front, Otto Powell. Matt Turner is the glue there in the middle. Jordan Grimes. And Sester is a youngster, and he may have his hands full tonight as Abby Amiri is the man that he'll be facing off against most all evening long. Fake the run. Going to go long up the far sideline. Got single coverage at the 2 yard line. A nice defensive play as it's knocked away by Ambrose Wooden, the junior out of Baltimore. And they wanted to go on top to Bryant, the speedster I was talking about.
And Purdue knew coming into this game there were some plays to be made downfield. And if you're going to make plays for Purdue, it's this guy, Dorian Bryant. But that is great coverage by Ambrose Wooden. And that has to be encouraging because that is the playmaker for Purdue right there. Number 9, Ambrose Wooden, stride for stride down that sideline.
And you need to know, Dorian Bryant told us that he has been timed in the 40 at 4-2-4. So that's pretty doggone good man coverage.
You see this new look Purdue offense using some option, a little different look.
They'll go with the running play with Boyd again, and Gerard is going to take it for about 5 yards or 5.5. The starters on defense for Notre Dame. Up front, Abiyam Marion, we talked about it. He's got speed and great mobility, and he's working against a very young tackle tonight. Laws, Landry, and Frome are the other down linemen. Brandon Hoyt, the leader of the linebackers, Mays and Maurice Crum Jr. And in the secondary, the cornerbacks are Wooden and Richardson. Zibikowski, a veteran player, will call his name a lot tonight. Here comes the option again, and they pitch it back. Great coverage by the defense, and Ray Williams on the end around is out there to make the hit. And now they scramble for the football. And the official says, nope, he was down right here at the 42. And Dukeway is the man who came up to make the play.
And you see right away the problems Purdue has had. They've implemented this option out of the spread. In the spring, Ron, they spent all their time working on the option, but can they execute it? That time they turned in Dukeway loose. Ray Williams, a wide receiver, unable to get a block on a big third down and four. So can you execute the scheme you implemented?
Zibikowski is the man deep, waiting to accept this punt from Brightus. Good pass in the left footer. This is a wobbly high kick. Gonna hit short. Now takes a big Purdue bounce and is going to be touched dead just inside the 10-yard line. 32 yards in the kick. We have no score. We'll take a break at the 11:20 mark of this first quarter. Welcome back to ESPN's College Football Primetime, presented by Polaroid. I'm Ron Franklin along with Bob Davey and Holly Rowe from West Lafayette, Indiana. No score. And Bob, we walked down on this beautiful playing surface yesterday, and the groundskeepers told us it's new. It is Kentucky bluegrass. And they say the roots are plenty long. It lays over a little, but it's still, it's a fast track.
Isn't it amazing when you go around this country? We did a Southeastern Conference game from Baton Rouge Monday night. Much faster track on that tight Bermuda grass down south.
Here's the pitch back going to Darius Walker. Tries to turn the corner, hemmed in. He's going to bring it back. His quarterback is there to block for him, and he's still going to be knocked down for a 5-yard loss. And let's check back at the studio with you, Reese Davis.
All right, Ron, got a Taco Bell studio update for you. USC and Arizona State. Sam Keller was picked off 5 times on the day, including this one by John Walker in the end zone. The senior who waited for that start, number one SC, 38-28 over the Sun Devils.
Okay, another one of those much anticipated meetings, but the Trojans, after having to come from behind, proving that they are still the number one team in the country. Play action, way back in the end zone. Over the middle, got a man, complete snowball up at the 24-yard line. And Bob, he is as good at timing that catch as any youngster I've seen.
That and also Brady Quinn, to me, throws these intermediate passes, these 20 to 25-yard square ends, as well as anybody in the country. And how about a 6'5 receiver, Stovall, coming across the middle and making this catch. But a great timing route. Also a 6'5 receiver in his last year of eligibility with a lot to prove if he wants to play in the NFL.
Joe Tiller was concerned. He told us yesterday with these tall Notre Dame receivers and cornerbacks that are about 5'9 and 5'10. Walker, nobody on the outside. 30, 35, 40. And he's going to wind up with a gain of very close to 20 yards in the play. Zach Logan with the block.
We look at these Notre Dame keys on offense. The first thing, keep the ball. The last 2 weeks against Michigan State and Washington, they held the ball 37 minutes. Protect the quarterback. Last 2 years, Purdue has knocked Brady Quinn down 48 times, which is amazing. And I think the third thing, beat man-to-man. Tonight, they will get man-to-man coverage at times for the first time this year. People have only played zone coverage against them up until this point.
By the way, on that last play, Santucci with a very good block. They're going to go back into the boundary again. Here's Walker. Takes it inside the 50 down to the 48-yard line. Bernard Pollard up from that strong safety position.
Coming in here and talking to Purdue's coaches, you get the feeling that Purdue's a little bit off balance, Ron, coming into this game. And the biggest reason to me, they have not played as well on defense as they expected. That combined with the changes they've made on offense with a little different scheme. But the biggest reason, not a real confident football team, because this defense has been a rock for them over the last several years.
Five carries for Darius Walker for 29 yards. They creep up. Here's the blitz. Scoville gets single coverage, catches the pass, and he's going to have the first down. He'll take it just inside the 45.
I think if you look at this Notre Dame offense, everybody wants to know what's the secret. You're not going to see one play that's any different. That it's not a Star Wars offense where it's some different scheme. What it is, it's the combination of doing a lot of things, and Charlie Weiss is able to do a lot of things because of an experienced football team.
And Purdue has a player shaken up at the 40-yard line. It looks as though Brian Hickman, the left cornerback, had gone down on one knee, and the training staff has come out to check him over. And it looks as though he is favoring either his right shoulder or right arm as they